Welcome back, everybody. I call to order the December meeting of the University of Minnesota Board of Regents. Good morning to one and all, and we are going to move right into our agenda. The first item of business before us this morning is approval of the October minutes. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Is second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any comments or discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 All right. Opposed? All right. Minutes are approved. Next, we'll hear the report of the president. President Gabel.
Thank you, Chair Powell, members of the board. It's been quite a fall semester on top of an extraordinary year at the University of Minnesota. A lot of the news will highlight and update later in today's agenda when we give our MPAC 2025 update in partnership with Provost Croson. But I do want to express my appreciation for the incredible road we've traveled together and for the opportunity to be in the position to work with and serve such an exceptional community of scholars, learners, innovators, and leaders. And it gives me much optimism about 2023 and the road that lies ahead. So, members of the board, a few updates for you. I'll start with public safety and public health. We continue to work diligently to ensure the health and safety of our university community. Later in this meeting, you'll hear an update on our public safety efforts. You'll also learn more about our Health Emergency Response Office, or HERO, which you've heard from before, and Dr. Jacob Toler as our campus public health officer, who've worked together to continue to adapt our public health plan in consultation with the COVID monitoring team and other key partners across the university. This layered approach has allowed us to utilize multiple mitigation strategies, and we look forward to keeping our university community advised through important messaging as we transition safely to the spring semester. A couple of other
Since the report of the overturning of Roe v. Wade by the U.S. Supreme Court, Students for a Democratic Society has been organizing on campus to protect and expand
rights. Can we have order, please?
We have organized marches, rallies, call-ins,
so
and more.
I think what I'll do is recess.
University administration.
Yeah. So, yet board so members, far, let's take a recess. And you know, you're welcome to stay, or if you want to get a drink, but we'll recess now.
Resources available on campus.
To order.
I've asked President Gabel to rewind a little bit in her report and then continue on.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. I just completed updating you on the work of Dr. Jacob Tolar and our HERO, or Health Emergency Response Office, on our plans for a safe transition into the spring semester. Following on that component of my report, I will come to an update on new leadership. We launched the Morris Chancellor search. It was great to participate in an open town hall and several listening sessions there last month. Special thanks to Acting Vice Chancellor of Academic Affairs and Dean Pei Eng of the Morris campus, and College of Education and Human Development Dean Michael Rodriguez on the Twin Cities campus, but Morris alum, for their leadership in co-chairing this important search. Late last month, with regard to leadership searches, Senior Vice President for Finance and Operations Myron Franz also launched the search for our next VP of University Services. My thanks to the search committee and to co-chairs Laura Molgaard, who's the Dean of the College of Veterinary Medicine, and Bernie Golichek, the Vice President of Information Technology and Chief Information Officer, who will be leading this search. And a special thanks to Matt Kramer, Vice President of University Relations, who's been serving as interim vice president. So we'll keep you updated on both of these searches and any others that emerge over the course of the road that we're traveling. With regard to university history, in February, you'll recall that the board approved the university's namings and renamings policy, including a 75-year sunset provision for honorary namings, which seeks to acknowledge the historical significance of each naming, but also acknowledge the evolving landscape of the university's past and future achievements. Since then, the university's All-University Honors Committee established a working group and then finalized the committee's naming criteria. Their next step was to address the four oldest honorifically named buildings, Falwell Hall, Sanford Hall, Keel Hall, and Spooner Hall, the last two being on the Crookston and Morris campuses, respectively. These all meet the 75-year sunset provision, and this group of four was decided in consultation with the All-University Honors Committee, taking into account specifically the capacity of that committee to address these questions year over year. On November 11th, we had our deadline for submissions to retain and or provide renaming requests for these four buildings, and now the AUHC will begin deliberating, expecting to finish their work later this spring. I anticipate reviewing their recommendations and bringing them forward for the board's final consideration later next spring. And I want to extend my sincere appreciation to the All-University Honors Committee, including Chair Tim Johnson, who've taken the lead in this really important work. They're pioneers in this work, and the committee's recommendations this coming spring we will bring forward, of course, with interest. I'd like to update you on some of our DEI efforts, and in particular, our campus climate survey. So, members of the board, in October, you heard an important presentation about our system-wide diversity, equity, and inclusion efforts that included a report compiled by Cambridge Hill Partners. As a key recommendation of that report, and in alignment with the AAU Advisory Board on Racial Equity in Higher Education that I was very honored to co-chair, I'm pleased to announce that we'll be administering a system-wide climate survey on diversity, equity, and inclusion during the spring 2023 semester. This work has previously been undertaken in different ways by colleges on the Twin Cities campus and across the system, but this is the first time we'll be looking at this effort system-wide, and it'll include all students, faculty, and staff, which will help us provide data that will be useful at the local and system level. Also in this work, as part of that AAU Advisory Board, we'll be collaborating with peers from Rutgers and the University of Illinois who have been undertaking similar planning meetings since May of 2020 to align our efforts and allow us to evaluate ourselves and where the sum of what we're doing should be greater than its parts. And I look forward to presenting the results of that survey to you as it concludes. So, members of the board, as a follow-up to our July meeting, yesterday the board's Finance and Operations Committee took up an MOU between the university and our 2026 Special Olympics USA Games, which provides access to university facilities and services on the Twin Cities campus and outlines the financial parameters for the university to host the games. We are so proud and excited to offer our world-class athletic, medical, housing, and dining facilities to the athletes, coaches, families, fans, and supporters alike, as we set to host the 2026 USA Games right here at the U. In that spirit, I want to take a moment to recognize Dave Dorn, the President and CEO of Special Olympics Minnesota, and Christy Sovereign, Senior Managing Director and Minneapolis Office Managing Director of Accenture and CEO of the 2026 Special Olympics USA Games, who are here with us today. So thank you very much. Thank you. Going right from that to peak. That's a bit of an abrupt transition, but I'd like to give you an update on our peak work. So achieving service excellence and consistency and offering services in the most cost-efficient but highest quality manner is a core focus, as you know, of our peak initiative and our collective action as reflected through Impact 2025. Over recent weeks, we've been working in very close partnership with the functional business partners, directors, managers, specialists, et cetera, and HR, finance, IT, marketing, and communications communities. We're continuing to work on the communication and consultation plans with different governance leaders, academic and administrative leaders, and other key stakeholder groups on a regular basis to make sure that this iterative process is clear and that we can refine it with appropriate input from all members of our community. And we also launched our first actual pilot where all newly initiated employee leaves will be managed in a central team of leave experts in the Office of Human Resources. So we look forward to bringing you more news and updates as the peak process continues to unfold. And as always, we welcome the university community's comments and questions as we work through this process, and we'll keep you posted on our next steps there. I'd like to give you an update on what's going on with Fairview and Sanford. As has been reported publicly, Sanford Health and Fairview Health Services have been engaged in discussions regarding the acquisition of Fairview by Sanford. We, of course, work with Sanford on our joint clinical enterprise, which we brand as mHealth Fairview. Three members of the University of Minnesota sit on the board of Fairview, and we have been vocal in our concerns that any acquisition must respect and resolve the key concerns of the university with respect to the independence of our medical faculty, who are also practicing physicians, the importance of our teaching mission, given our role in educating over 70% of the physicians in Minnesota, and finally, the continued financial support that any merged entity must continue to contribute to the academic medicine mission in recognition of the strength of our healthcare brand and impact. We are committed to working with Fairview as they examine this opportunity, but we want to make sure that it's clear that we will not compromise on our core commitments to Minnesota and Minnesotans. So while Fairview welcomes Sanford's interest, given their financial challenges, the university's perspective is grounded in our calling to serve the healthcare needs of all Minnesotans. Our mission is to educate the best physicians in the world, ground them in cutting-edge treatments and research that improves the lives of all Minnesotans, and do so while never forgetting the humanity that every one of our patients expects in receiving compassionate care from our faculty physicians and other healthcare professionals. I know that Chair Powell will also comment on this during his report, so I'll reserve any additional comments on healthcare for a more focused session, but I do want our community, all Minnesotans, and this board to know that we will not compromise on our mission in any respect as we work with Fairview on their clear business and financial challenges. So members of the board, since our last meeting, I want to give you an update on some of the events and meetings that I've participated in. We were able to participate in the Council on Competitiveness's National Competitiveness Forum. We participated in Equity in the Alley, which is put on by Medical Alley, Give to the Max Day, which is put on by the Foundation, the NCAA's Pathway Program. I was very honored to participate in the Carlson's First Tuesday Program with James White, the Larson Scholars Luncheon, and the Minnesota Business Partnership's annual dinner. I had the pleasure of joining Regent Verhaelen at Fashion Fest 2022. We gave our regular interviews at the dailies at the table with Gable, and I was able to be a speaker for the Edina Rotary Club. And we've welcomed delegations from the Air Force Office of Scientific Research and the Mellon Foundation. I had the chance to travel to Arizona to engage with donors and, as described earlier, go to Morris to attend listening sessions for the chancellor's search. We had some fun away games, and I was in Indianapolis recently for Big Ten meetings and the championship game. I was at the Big Ten board meeting, the MBOLD meetings, Fulbright meetings, AAU meetings, and APLU meetings, where I am now winding down my term as the CC commissioner and will move into a regular and somewhat less time-consuming seat on their executive committee. I also had the pleasure of visiting with the Twin Cities Deans, our System Council, Senior Leadership Team, Cabinet, Budget 6, the FCC, FARS, our undergraduate shared governance, graduate shared governance, professional student shared governance foundation, and the overall university senate. And we have begun our process of engaging in the legislative session with our kickoff meeting with the governor's office. So it's a busy fall semester, as they always are at this time of year. I'm very grateful for the many opportunities I've had to engage in recent weeks. So members of the board, as we are very happy to do, I'd like to close my report with some shout outs that make all of us UMN proud. So a shout out from a recent announcement from research.com that the U ranked number 20 globally, number 16 nationally, and second in the Big Ten only behind Michigan based on H index and D index in their respective fields of study. A shout out to our students for leading the U to be recognized as a 2022 all-in engaged campus for college student voting. A shout out to the Minnesota School of Law. 97% of first-time test takers passed the July 2022 bar exam, which is the highest pass rate in the state. In sum, at 96%, our 2022 results slightly exceeded last year's rate, which is the law school's second highest pass rate since the introduction of the uniform bar exam in 2014. A shout out to the College of Liberal Arts Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. program, which received the Association of Black Culture Centers accreditation. The program is the first to receive that accreditation. And lastly, a shout out about great recent happenings across the university on a video. Mr. Chair, I wish you, the board, and our university family the warmest, safest, healthiest, and very happiest holiday season and New Year, and that concludes my report.
Thank you, President Gabel. Thanks for that report. Terrific report, and back at you. We wish you a good holiday season.
Thank you.
Turning to my report, I first want to highlight all the strong governance work being advanced this month, all of which directly ties to the priorities that we established this past summer. Continued implementation of the Impact 2025 system-wide strategic plan continues to be our top priority, and later in this meeting we'll hear a progress report on that. And yesterday, Finance and Operations Committee acted on multiple agreements for the university's labor-represented staff, and I want to thank each of our union employees for their dedication to our wonderful institution. We cannot achieve our mission, we cannot advance without you, and we are grateful. In the Mission Fulfillment Committee, we heard about the tremendous success we're having in research. As a top public research university, this is an area of tremendous strength for the University of Minnesota. But it's very competitive, and the competition for new sponsored research funding is, it's fierce, which means that this is going to have to remain a very important area of focus. Few words about public safety, which remains of utmost importance to this board and the university's administration. I've read all the letters we've received from members of the community. I understand the worry that you feel. The university continues to take a comprehensive and widespread strategy. We've invested significantly in services, such as Gopher Chauffeur, Dinkytown Safety Guide, 624 Walk, Rave Guardian. We've invested in infrastructure, lighting, cameras, kiosks, community and business engagement like the pilot programs in Dinkytown, and other efforts, some suggested by the university's Strategic Safety Advisory Committee. The issue remains that these are often crimes of opportunity, and we need to work collectively to enhance safety. To all of those listening, please review the university's Safe Campus website, and please make use of the resources we provide, like Campus Safe Walk, Rave Guardian, Campus Safety App, and the Gopher Chauffeur program. University of Minnesota Police Department Chief Matt Clark is working closely with the Minneapolis Police Department leadership, and our relationship with them is strong. But challenges remain, and these challenges result from very significant staffing shortages, which have been really, really difficult to overcome. Later in this meeting, we'll hear more on university effort in this area. I want to emphasize this board's commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion. Not only is DEI a central anchor of the MPACT 2025 system-wide strategic plan, which this board has fully endorsed, but we are daily reminded that the strength of the university lies in the diversity of our community. We're inspired every day by that diversity, and it drives our institution forward. And as chair, I'm committed to building this board's DEI capacity to help us more fully understand and reaffirm the power that different perspectives bring to our shared success. At my request, board staff has been gathering information about potential tools and experts that could be engaged to support this work. I want to thank new Vice President Mercedes Ramirez Hernandez for being a partner to the board in this work. Her early advice and ongoing commitment to assist us is greatly appreciated. I'm heartened by the input we've received from faculty, and will continue to look to these internal experts as we elevate DEI work within the board and across the university. I also plan to tap into the expertise that exists right on the board. Regent Talurabe has been particularly helpful in framing my thinking, and I'll be relying on her and others as we move forward. Diversity is, it's not a challenge, it's a strength. And it's a strength that makes the entire system one of the most highly regarded in the country. And finally, picking up from President Gabel's comments, I also want to call attention to the recent acquisition talks that Fairview Health Services and Sanford Health have engaged in, with Sanford proposing to substitute itself as the sole member of the Minnesota nonprofit Fairview Health Services. The media and others are understandably focused on the business of healthcare. Experts debate whether this transaction will cause costs to go up or down or stay the same. These are all fair questions given the challenges of healthcare marketplace and the financial concerns facing Fairview in particular. Like all consumers of healthcare, I appreciate that this debate matters a great deal. But for the University of Minnesota, and in particular, our medical school, this is about our mission, our physician, both those practicing and those in training, and most importantly, our patients and the future of Minnesota's public health. And I respectfully urge those who care about the health of Minnesotans to hold Fairview to its mission as a Minnesota nonprofit to serve the immediate and long-term needs of Minnesotans. The right question is, what is best for Minnesota in the years to come, not what might be best for Fairview financially. The president noted in her remarks that the university's mission finds us educating over 70% of the practicing physicians in Minnesota rural or metro, family practitioner or the most advanced cardiologist, our work affects the lives of every Minnesotan. And our concerns regarding this merger should never be construed as being limited to the nature of a business transaction. We operate by the singular aspect of our mission to prioritize patient care, to help, to assist, and most of all, to provide the expertise, the judgment, and the compassion that Minnesotans deserve in their moment of care. I add that our thoughts are also with the many employees of Fairview who support our practitioners. The healthcare industry is stressed as it is, and these employees deserve consideration as well. Minnesota expects us to teach and retain top-of-class doctors and offer sophisticated care to treat the most complex medical needs. And Minnesota must support a future where its university, and thereby Minnesota, governs and controls its destiny. That does not necessarily preclude affiliation with Sanford or others, but we ask our public officials to judge any proposed reformation of Fairview by whether it is designed to serve the teaching, research, and clinical care needs of this state's only public medical school. Minnesota, do your part, and you'll find the university very ready to do ours. Finally, as we wrap up 2022, I want to acknowledge and express gratitude for the university's outstanding faculty and staff. I recently had a chance to meet with some of our faculty and staff, and I was reminded again of the countless ways they serve this huge enterprise in teaching, research, and service. The board is deeply grateful to all of you. We thank each and every one of you for your service and commitment to the university. So I'll conclude my report there, and we'll turn to the next agenda item. We will now hold the election for our vice chair position. I believe all of you are familiar with the process we'll follow, but just to be sure, I'm going to briefly review it. In accordance with the board's bylaws, we will be electing someone to fill the unexpired term for this position, which runs through June 30th, 2023, and in a moment, I'll open the floor for nominations. If there is only one nominee, a regent may move to elect that individual by unanimous consent. If there are two or more nominees, the board will hold a roll call vote. The first nominee receiving at least 7 votes will be elected. If there are 3 or more nominees and no one's elected on the first 4 ballots, candidates with the least number of votes will be dropped and voting will continue. After all nominations have been made, I'll entertain brief comments or discussion, and then we'll move to the vote. With that, are there nominations for the position of vice chair? Regent Johnson.
I nominate Regent Mehron.
Thank you, Regent Johnson. Are there other nominations? Regent Farnsworth.
Thank you, Chair Powell. I would place myself into nomination.
Thank you, Regent Farnsworth. Are there other nominations? Okay. Regent Mehron has been nominated for the position of vice chair. Regent Farnsworth has been nominated for the position of vice chair. I'm going to ask them first to make any comments that they would like to make, and then I'll open the floor to others. So Regent Mehron, as you were first to be nominated, we'll go to you first.
Thank you. First of all, thank you, Regent Johnson, for the nomination. I will take, if I am elected, I will.
Sorry, Regent Mehron, could you pull your microphone closer
certainly,
to you? My
certainly.
Apologies. Thank you.
You bet.
I am now the microphone.
All right, the microphone police. All right. If I'm elected, I will take this position very seriously, as I have done with my role as a regent here since 2019 when I came on as regent. I obviously have a love for the university. I have a long-standing connection with the university, both as an undergrad and as a law school graduate, also as a former president of the Alumni Association. And I think most importantly, I have a long history in governance and being on different boards. And in my role as a magistrate judge with the federal court, and working with people, different constituencies, people with different interests, to work to gather and hopefully create consensus for whatever it is that we are attempting to achieve, and to work with all of those parties to hopefully come to the best result, which would serve the University of Minnesota and the state of Minnesota. So I believe I have the skill set to lead in this role, and if I had to step into the position of chair, if Chair Powell was not able to do so, to be able to step into that position as well. I think my history in governance and my attachment to the university and my skill set that I bring would allow me to be the kind of leader that I think the university deserves in this position. So again, thank you, Regent Johnson, for the nomination. And if elected, I will do my very best to serve to the best of my ability. Thank you.
Thank you, Regent Mayeron. Regent Farnsworth.
Thanks, Chair Powell, for the opportunity to read some brief remarks about my candidacy. So I'll go forward and do that. I ran for this board because I believe strongly in the mission and incredible impact of this institution, knowing that the University of Minnesota does so much good for not only the state of Minnesota, but our entire world. And I think the video shout out that we just watched and had the opportunity to watch every meeting really highlights that and so much more. And so I consider it a sincere honor and privilege to serve in the position of regent and be one of 12 who carries a fiduciary duty, duty of care, and duty of loyalty to this institution. And since being elected, I have devoted a lot of time to being prepared for board business, doing my homework, and engaging with many different constituencies whose experiences and perspectives make me a more well-informed and well-rounded trustee. So to speak to the circumstances around this election in particular and why I've decided to place my name in the ring to be vice chair. I decided to place my name into nomination because I believe diversity in generation, ethnicity, race, experience, and other elements are important for the leadership of this board. I consider my governance and leadership style to be one of collaboration, mutual respect, deep engagement, and listening and public service. And if elected, I would look forward to the opportunity to not only work together with colleagues on this board, but to continue my philosophy and practice of doing as much listening and learning as possible with groups across the university system. I want to end on this point by saying I believe that the combination of my background, experience on this board and on many other outside governing boards, and the perspective of providing a uniquely qualified lens to help lead and tackle the immediate diversity, equity, inclusion, engagement, and other board business that we need to build on as a board in the near term makes me uniquely qualified for this position. And it would be an honor to be elected to this important transitional leadership opportunity. And I respectfully ask my colleagues for their support. Thank you, Chair Powell.
Thank you, Regent Farnsworth. I'm going to open it up the floor now for other comments. Regent Johnson, as you nominated Regent Mayeron, I'll ask you to go first.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This university is a national and international research entity, and it's known for academic excellence. And we expect excellence from our faculty and staff, and we should expect no less from the leadership of our board. So Regent Mayeron was very modest about her background. She graduated from the University of Minnesota summa cum laude and also was a member of Phi Beta Kappa. She graduated from the law school and has had a long career with some great law firms in this region. Also, she was a federal magistrate, which is a very important appointment. She has more awards and accolades than I can list here. But having, you know, seen a lot of federal judges and federal magistrates work, they are required to hear both sides and make decisions on a daily basis. And I actually, my remarks are written on the back of a amendment that Regent Mayeron wrote yesterday, but so she combs through the all the materials and is extraordinarily well prepared, as I'm guessing she was for law school and being a federal magistrate. So We saw her, we've seen her ability to chair difficult meetings as she did yesterday. And she has the qualities of someone who's run a courtroom, which, you know, there's a fairness behind her ability to chair a meeting. And also, as a former judge, I find her slightly intimidating. So.
Oh, dear.
Regent Mayeron has lived her life taking the lead in public service and in service to the University of Minnesota, and I can't think of a better vice chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Regent Johnson. Other comments? Regent Rocha.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We're fortunate to have quality candidates from whom to select. You know, having served with a whole bunch of vice chairs now over time, it is an important position. And for me, on behalf of the good people of Minnesota's 3rd Congressional District and the rest of the state, as we all represent, I very much seek inclusion. I like to be part of the dialogue at a time when it's relevant, and oftentimes I feel that the only opportunity to weigh in on matters of significance is after the die is cast, and the discussion is somewhat of a formality. And so when I'm thinking between the candidates in front of us, I have not heard, I was actually a bit surprised by the nomination, in part based on a conversation I'd had with one of my colleagues about the importance of diversity, but also because I hadn't heard from Regent, you know, Mayeron as you know, if she was interested in this, and I you know, if she does prevail, I hope that's not indicative of future processes where, again, I feel like I don't hear about things until it's already cast in stone. Whereas I would point out with Regent Farnsworth, he has maintained fairly close contact over time about different issues, contacting me to, one, seek a bit of a historical perspective that he knows I'm fairly aggressive about offering, whether people want it or not. But to me, that's important, and I think that he would bring that to this position where all members of the board would probably be tired of hearing from the vice chair in making sure that their perspectives are understood as we are in the process of formulating the process to formulate policy. I would also note that this is, you know, a somewhat of a big moment for me, because in 14 years of regenting over several decades, this will be the first time that I will get to vote for a person from a community of color to serve in leadership on the Board of Regents. It hasn't happened in over two decades. And I think that is significant, particularly on the heels of Chair Powell's very strong and appropriate statement about our commitment to diversity. And diversity doesn't only come in statistical analysis, but also in visible representation. Now, there are always excuses for delaying diversity. We can rattle off resumes ad nauseum to validate the established choices. I think that our communities of color are very familiar with that experience. But by performance, I'm convinced that Regent Farnsworth has the skills and the maturity and a commitment to the full board to ensure all board members representing all corners of the state would be included in those important conversations. And I think that he would be an excellent vice chair in our leadership team, and I would urge you to vote for Regent Farnsworth for vice chair. Thank you.
Thank you, Regent Rocha. Regent Johnson.
Thank you, Chair Powell. I would like to follow up on the comments of our colleague, Regent Tad Johnson. And first of all, I want to affirm that diversity is very important. Diversity of gender, race, age, and life experiences. Been in medicine long enough myself that when I was a student, medical student, I worked at a context where we had 600 physicians and only 15 were women. That's 2.5%. I had a great education in one way, but it was clearly from a single perspective. And for context here, I would like to note that over the last 20 years, We've only had two women serve as chair of this board. The University of Minnesota Board of Regents has increased its diversity in recent years. As recently as 2019, we had three women on the board. At that time, Regents Mayron, Davenport, and Herr were elected, and also Regent Kenyanya. And so at that point, there were three women and two members of a BIPOC community. Last year in 2021, among the elected regents were Regents Farnsworth, Verhaelen, and myself. And then with the subsequent appointments of Regents Tau Urabi and Tad Johnson, we now have, I think, the most diverse group of regents ever. If I'm wrong, please correct me. But among our 12, we have five women and four members of the BIPOC community. I applaud this, and I believe it's imperative that we have diverse voices at this table, our horseshoe. We bring diverse experiences and perspectives to our work. Now, in terms of board leadership, the nine of us who've been joining to this board in 2019 or thereafter are all in the process of training for us to then be able to best assume the roles of higher board leadership. And our early leadership is as vice chairs and chairs of our committees, and we're all engaged in that. But today we're voting for a new vice chair of our full board. This is a very important role, and one with the expectation that this region can perform when needed now as a chair, and that within a year or two may well be elevated or voted to the board chair position. I believe that success in this leadership role requires strong educational foundation, significant career experiences, whether it be in business, education, or the professions. It also requires maturity, integrity, wisdom, and a healthy sense of humility despite career successes. I know that Regent Mayron possesses these qualities. She has had years of stellar work as an attorney and as a judge, a federal magistrate. I believe those experiences make her the best candidate to assume the role of vice chair of this board. As noted, she also has deep experience at the University of Minnesota, undergraduate studies, law school, president of the Alumni Association. She has the skill set to do this. So for those reasons, I intend to support Regent Mayron, and I hope you will all consider joining me in that. Thank you.
Thank you, Regent Johnson. Regent Swigum.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Colleagues, I want to thank you each very, very sincerely for the honor of serving as your vice chair for the last 3.5 years. Thank you.
Regent Tau Urabi.
Thank you, Chair Powell. I just wanted to provide a couple of comments. One, I think that this sort of comes on the heels of my recent visit to the Equal Justice Initiative, which is in Montgomery. I was just there last week, so there a lot of it is still resonating for me. But first, I also want to just thank my colleagues, Regent Mayron and Regent Farnsworth, for stepping up and being interested in this role. I certainly have never served on a board like this, but having served on boards, I understand the time and commitment and, you know, how just what kind of dedication is essential for being successful in a leadership position of a board, and certainly one of this magnitude. So appreciate both of your willingness and commitment to step into and to put your names in the hat for this position. Having said that, I do think that diversity is very important to the success of this university. At every turn, if any of our students, faculty, workers feel like they are not fully welcomed and embraced, we lose out on kind of their full potential. And that is, that's not only a loss for that individual, but it is a loss for certainly this university and then the people of Minnesota. So to me, diversity is always an asset. That doesn't mean it's easy, but it certainly is important for our future. Having said that, I do think that the reason why we're in this special election is really this question of diversity. And I hope that also hearing the president's report about what the staff will undertake in order for us to really understand, and then our own commitments to Impact 2025, that the issue is, should be and is front and center, and that the representation alone is not enough. And I, too, am incredibly proud to serve at this time when we have the most diverse Board of Regents that this university has had. I think it says a lot, and the leadership understands that. So I also do think that it is important that we not use the moment to talk about tokenizing and just creating a seat because we are in a difficult position. I think it is the time when we should actually double down on our commitment to diversity and to find ways to actually work on them. So to me, for today, I'm voting on both understanding our commitment as a university, and then also thinking about the commitment that we as a board, and also the individual that will be in this position, has to actually carry out kind of the work. And I'm fortunate that I've had a chance to both talk to Regent Mayron and Regent Farnsworth, and I know their dedication, but I, for today, will be supporting Regent Mayron and urge my colleagues to as well.
Thank you, Regent Taliarabi. Any other comments? All right, I'm just going to look around. Regent Kenyanya.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, everyone who's spoken, Regent Farnsworth, Regent Mayron. I really initially wasn't going to speak because it's difficult, but I feel like that's a bit of a cop-out. We should discuss things and whether, easy or not. So with regards to Regent Farnsworth, we had the chance to speak at length, for a while about the candidacy, as well as our governance philosophies, where they align, where they differ. I think that was a really productive conversation and something that we concluded that really each of us should get the chance to do one-on-one for 2 hours if you'd like, or shorter if you wouldn't like. Regent Mayron, I guess I wasn't, quite frankly, officially aware of the candidacy, but was aware of it just from hearing. But I did I think I really insisted on your candidacy last time that we went through the election cycle. It's obviously no secret why there's the vacancy and why we've ended up here. And I think all the comments and considerations made by colleagues are valid and make sense. Diversity is certainly important, but I mean, Bo, it is your name, but my apologies, did bring up, an important point of, tokenization. Isn't that itself is not enough? And thinking about this, I was even thinking about just how we frame some of these things around my election, and that was a big theme. And I remember I always bring this up. President Gabel on her inauguration day was asked about being the first female president, and I think you said, "Well, I've always been a woman." So that's an interesting way to think about it. But I don't know. I imagine a lot of folks are maybe thinking this a step further, and I don't know if it's an appropriate thing to say, but we're aware that the chair is up for election, and that's an uncertain candidacy. So, it's hard not to And we even talked about this. It's hard not to think about that next step and whatever. So I don't know that I articulated myself very well and happy to discuss further, but at this time, I will be supporting Regent Mehran as well. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Any other? Thank you,
Mr. Chair.
So I think we'll hear.
Mr. Chair.
Yeah, well, I think we'll hear from.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Regent Rocha, and then
thank you.
I think that will conclude. Yeah, the discussion.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, I appreciate the commentary. I do want to address what I think is a pretty strong bit of language, though. It appears that the speeches are written and the votes are fairly well cast, so I'm not changing that. But I want to just ensure that my position is based on the fact that I think that we're fortunate to have strong candidates. My support for Regent Farnsworth is based on my belief that he has a commitment to the inclusion that I think is helpful in a board where there's a leadership board dynamic. I'm especially concerned about the term tokenizing or tokenism because quite frankly that's the term that is used most frequently by people who are opposed to advancing diversity in that respect, and by no means would I want that to be any way characterizing my support for I think an excellent candidate. And so with that, I will continue to support Regent Farnsworth.
Okay, and I would also like to thank both candidates for their willingness to stand. It's a big job, and grateful. So given that we have two nominations, our bylaws require us to take a roll call vote. Regent Mehran and Regent Farnsworth have both been nominated for the position of vice chair. Mr. Steves, are we ready to proceed to the roll call?
All right. Mr. Chair, yes.
So Mr. Steves will call the roll, and when you're called on, simply state the name of the individual you wish to vote for. So, Mr. Steves.
For election to the position of vice chair, Regent Davenport.
Regent Mehran.
Regent Davenport votes Mehran. Regent Farnsworth.
Regent Farnsworth.
Regent Farnsworth votes Farnsworth. Regent Hipsch.
Regent Mehran.
Regent Hipsch votes Mehran. Regent Ruth Johnson.
Regent Mehran.
Regent Ruth Johnson votes Mehran. Regent Tad Johnson.
Regent Mehran.
Regent Tad Johnson votes Mehran. Regent Kenyanya.
Regent Mehran.
Regent Kenyanya votes Mehran. Regent Mehran.
Regent Mehran.
Regent Mehran votes Mehran. Regent Rocha.
Regent Farnsworth.
Regent Rocha votes Farnsworth. Regent Swigum.
Regent Farnsworth.
Regent Swigum votes Farnsworth. Regent Taurabi.
Regent Mehran.
Regent Taurabi votes Mehran. Regent Verhalen.
Regent Mehran.
Regent Verhalen votes Mehran. Chair Powell.
Regent Mehran.
Chair Powell votes Regent Mehran.
Okay, by a vote of 9-3, Regent Mehran is elected vice chair. Regent Mehran, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Regent Farnsworth.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I think it's important to be gracious in defeat, and so I want to be the first one to say congratulations to Vice Chair Mehran, and it's a pleasure to say that to a fellow Highland Park Senior High School graduate. So congratulations, Vice Chair Mehran, and I look forward to working with you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the comments.
Did you guys know each other there?
I think there was a few year gap.
It's part of our age diversity.
All right, and just so again, I want thanks to both of you for standing. Thanks to everyone on the board for very eloquent and very thoughtful commentary on this issue. And thanks to Regent Swigum for his service. Thank you. All right, next I'll note our receive and file item, which is the East Cliff Annual Report. And I think that's all I'm gonna do is I'll note it. And now we'll move to consider the consent report. Is there a motion to approve the consent report?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion of the consent report? Seeing that there are no questions or comments, I'll ask for all of those in favor of the consent report to signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? All right, that's approved. All right, next we're gonna formally review the 2022 University Performance and Accountability Report, which outlines ways we are delivering on our mission. This report is closely related to the MPACT 2025 System-Wide Strategic Plan, and as we go forward, you'll see them become more integrated. The report is before us for review today and will return for action in February. President Gabel, I think, wants to lead us off, and then we'll turn to Provost Croson for some highlights on the report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the board. So just a little context. In February 2021, the board approved measures and metrics for MPACT 2025. So we've been working under that rubric for the last 22 months, and our collective work as a university community has helped us to diligently advance these work streams. We've had record-breaking impact and world-class outcomes for the state of Minnesota, Minnesotans, and beyond. And importantly, we are stronger and better as a system. And I want to express my pride and appreciation for what we've accomplished together, our shared commitments, especially while navigating these very interesting and historic times that we've all been experiencing. I want to give a big shout out to Link Carlson and the Institutional Analysis Team and Laura Johnson and the University Relations Team and Marlo Welshans, in the Provost's Office and the entire Provost's Office team for everything they do to get us here today, along with everyone who actually does all the work that we measure and report through the course of the strategic planning process. So members of the board, it's in this spirit that we undertake a review of year two of MPACT 2025 and highlight our shared work, which now, as we've reported over time, is in full alignment with our university accountability report. The provost will go into greater detail in just a few moments, but I want to offer a few highlights about the incredible progress we've made through MPACT 2025 and why we have the metrics and measures that we do. When we do strategic planning, you may recall from very early in the process that we have three overarching goals, that we want to have clarity about what it is we're doing, that we want to have transparency and accountability about how well we're doing it, and we want to have a source of inspiration and pride in our community to show the impact that we're making and that we are mission-bound and honored to be able to fulfill. And so all of the metrics and measures that you're going to hear about tie into those three overarching goals, like record-setting research, over $1 billion 2 years in a row, record startups and patents that we discussed yesterday in our research presentation during mission fulfillment, record four-year graduation rates, our highest grad rate in half a century, record philanthropy, our first year post the historic driven campaign, which also represents the first time the university has crossed the critical $400 million per year threshold, the most diverse freshman class in our history, the most Minnesotan high school graduates as freshmen at a UMN campus in history. In fact, 7 out of 10 of our freshman class are Minnesotans, and the 6,700 plus new freshmen on the Twin Cities campus is our second largest cohort in half a century. And importantly, these outcomes are tied to our comprehensive system-wide enrollment management strategy, which is an important priority of MPACT 2025 and of this board. Over this past year, we re-envisioned healthcare education with the launch of Next Gen Med and strengthened Minnesota's deep connection to the food and ag world with the launch of Next Gen Ag's pilot just last month. We moved into the top 25 amongst public universities, according to US News, an increase of 8 spots. And 12 of our subject areas are in the top 25 in the world in the 2022 Shanghai rankings. We have always been committed to students across the board, but deepened in particular the university's student mental health commitment through PRISM, or the President's Initiative for Student Mental Health, and strengthened our relations with our tribal community partners. I'm particularly proud of how our sense of belonging amongst Twin Cities undergraduate students nears 90%, particularly in light of all we have endured as a university community during these recent times. We have established a new university namings and renamings policy, and as an important next step, we are reviewing honorary namings, starting with the 4 oldest buildings, Falwell Hall, Sanford Hall on the Twin Cities campus, and Keel Hall and Spooner Hall on the Crookston and Morris campuses, respectively. We are deeply committed to being good stewards of our resources and are creating greater operational efficiency through the PEAK initiative, including to reduce the percentage of total expenditures spent on administration from 11.6% to 10.8%, a key Impact 2025 outcome, but also while advancing innovative financing to support long-term strategic objectives, including the sale of $500 million in 30-year bonds, which we updated you on yesterday. We took important steps to advance our work in rankings around the world by aligning with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, establishing a top 20 U.S. Sustainable Development Goal ranking, including number 16 globally for zero hunger, and our good health and well-being ranking, where we are number 2 in the United States. We also initiated action towards establishing a next generation climate action plan for the entire system, which we will complete by 2025, and hired a chief sustainability officer, altogether coalescing rural, urban, business, science, farmers, environmentalists, and other stakeholders to develop and scale up Minnesota-based solutions for sustained impact at home and across the globe. Tied to our service and engagement mission, which is also a core pillar of Impact 2025, I'm so proud of our successful competitive bid to host the 2026 Special Olympics USA Games right here on our Twin Cities campus. And as you will hear about later in this meeting, we continue to take important steps around public safety as we seek safety for our entire community in every sense of that word. So members of the board, over the last year, and critical to all of this work as a university system, you heard from our campuses in Crookston, Duluth, Morris, and Rochester on how our Impact 2025 measures, as well as their individual campus and college strategic plans, align with the overall measures that you're about to hear about, demonstrating that anything is possible if we are creative, committed, and take care of each other, that our shared impact is greater than the sum of its parts. It elevates our state, it honors our 170-year-plus legacy, and ensures that from Crookston to Duluth, Morris to Rochester, and to the Twin Cities, our best days lie ahead. So, Mr. Chair, with that, I'd like to turn it over to Provost Croson to continue the presentation.
Thank you, President Gabel. Provost Croson.
Thank you, Chair Powell, President Gabel, members of the board. I want to add my thanks and an acknowledgement to all of those who have worked this past year to track these Impact 25 metrics and to gather the data we need to produce this report. But I especially want to thank all of those whose efforts have generated the underlying outcomes which this report reflects. This work is a true system-wide collaboration involving all of our leaders, instructors, and staff across all 5 of our campuses. As we do each December, we bring you today's report for your review. The final report will come before you for action in February. Between now and then, we will incorporate any corrections from our final proofreading or adjustments driven by today's conversation. I'm not going to discuss each measure across all 5 commitment areas. First of all, there's a lot, but also because much of what we're reporting here has been or will be the subject of more in-depth presentations over the course of the year. For example, Vice President Priya provided a robust presentation yesterday that addressed many of the aspects of the Discovery, Innovation, and Impact Commitment. I will, however, offer a few highlights. First, a couple of metrics related to our commitment to Minnesota students. The vast majority of our incoming class this year are Minnesotan, and this is the second largest total number of Minnesota residents we have enrolled since at least 1987, which is when we started to collect data by geography. And crucial to our goal to keep our high school students in the state and have them choose the University of Minnesota, we landed our highest share of high school graduates. In my mind, this is the most important measure we have of our service to the state. Continuing on the theme of record-setting numbers, our incoming class this fall was the most diverse ever. Our land-grant mission compels us to empower individuals from all communities in Minnesota. Thus, our campuses must reflect the demographics of those communities. While our work is not yet done, I am encouraged by the news that our efforts are producing the results that we can continue to build on. Also encouraging is the strong percentage of undergraduates who reported that they have a sense of belonging on the Twin Cities campus undergraduate SERU survey. Bringing diverse students to our campuses is not enough. We need to create and sustain the type of environments where they can succeed and thrive. As President Gable mentioned, the new system-wide climate survey will provide a deeper dive and data across our system from students, faculty, and staff. This slide highlights this year's retention and graduation rates, which remain strong despite the interference of the pandemic. The graduation rates we calculate for our campuses, and which are reported here and on the progress card, count students graduating from any campus in the system, regardless of their transfer activity. In other words, if a student starts at Rochester, but transfers to and graduates from the Twin Cities campus, Rochester gets the credit for that student's success. Where these situate each campus in relation to the goals reported in the progress is reported on the progress card on page 9 for the Twin Cities campus and in each enrollment presentation and docket for the Crookston, Duluth, Morris, and Rochester campuses. We've also included tables within each campus overview, pages 14 to 23 of the accountability report, that show how our graduation rates position each campus within their peer group. One thing to note is that when comparing with other institutions, we use data from IPEDS, which is the National Clearinghouse, and the most recent official data has a 2-year lag. So the graduation rate of 72% for the Twin Cities in this table doesn't match our 75.3% from the previous table, which is the current number. This data places the Twin Cities campus tied for second among Big Ten publics in 4-year graduation rates and tied for fourth among our broader set of peers, with only Michigan, UCLA, and Berkeley ahead of us. Another important metric is related to our efforts to develop innovative, coordinated, and scaled system-wide distributed learning models that increase access and meet workforce needs. To achieve our goal, we're continuing to develop programs using the innovative NextGen platform. In June, we'll provide an update in the Mission Fulfillment Committee on our distributed education goals and progress more generally. And in a mission fulfillment presentation earlier this fall, Extension Dean Beverly Durgan provided in-depth information about the extensive reach that Extension has across the state. This year's data demonstrates an increase of 20% in the number of partnerships that Extension has, and Extension is going to continue to work and to build and maintain these partnerships. At yesterday's Mission Fulfillment meeting, you heard from Vice President Priya on the topic of discovery, innovation, and impact. He had a lot of impressive data to show you, and we're all excited to see where his leadership will lead us. Today, I'd like to underscore two important points from his presentation. Our record research expenditures put us among an elite group of institutions, and that there are plans in place to continue to grow these expenditures and thus our impact. Finally, I'd like to touch on our commitment of fiscal stewardship. From my admittedly biased perception, the most important aspect to being responsible stewards of our resources is how we work to support our students, and in particular, our commitment to keep student debt below the national average. Two of the levers we have that in this area involve the distribution of gift aid and providing more opportunities for our students to be employed on campus. And we've seen success in each of these areas over the past year. Chair Powell, thank you for the chance to discuss a few key metrics in this report. President Gable and I welcome your questions and thoughts.
All right. Provost Croson, thank you very much for that overview. And while we're waiting for a few hands to go up, maybe I'll ask a question. Rachel, the metrics that you and President Gable have put in place, I think are you know, they go more broadly across the university, and and quite deep, really, in a way that we've not seen until the implementation of this plan. Maybe if you could make a few comments on how that's working. Anything need to be improved or fixed, or is it? And are we happy that the use of the metrics and the way that you're using them are driving, you know, the behaviors that we want to see?
Thank you, Chair Powell, members of the board. I'll let President Gable speak for herself, but I've been very happy with the strategic plan. I have a quantitative background as an economist, and I firmly believe that you measure what you get and you get what you measure. And that having quantitative specific goals that we can shoot for really inspires our behavior. As I've discussed at a previous meeting, the performance evaluations of the deans and the budget processes that we've put in place are tied to these metrics. And I firmly believe that having everybody on the same page, having something that's explicit, is very important to make sure that all of our efforts are aligned and we're all rowing in the same direction.
All right, good. It's good to hear. Thank you. Regent Kish.
Thank you, Chair Powell. Just a question on slide 93 on the startups. 22 startups. Can you tell me how long of a period of time are those 22 startups? And secondly, what's the economic impact of those startups? And, is one of them going to become the next Fortune 500 company? We don't know that, but that's my question. Thank you.
Thank you, Regent Hips, Chair Powell. My understanding from Vice President Priya's presentation yesterday, and we can check with him, I think he's in the room, is that that's 22 startups over the last year. So that's a year-to-year measure. As you mentioned, hard to measure economic impact, especially for new companies. But that is absolutely something that we track for our portfolio, and I'm happy to give you some information about that.
Sounds good. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Regent Hips. Regent Swigum.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. My question, Rachel, predates you. And it predates everybody here on this horseshoe, except for maybe Regent Rocha and Regent Powell and former Regent McMillan. And I go to the chart that you had about belonging to the university community, 88%. I think 88% was the chart. Awesome, wonderful, that everybody needs to feel belonged and part of the community. I think it was 2017. It might have been 2018, and I don't have it in front of me. I keep it in my file, though, because it's very, very important to me. We did a similar survey, and, of course, we asked belonging to the university community by religion, by race, by gender, by everything, including political philosophy. And if you remember correctly, Mr. Rocha, Mr. Paul, that survey showed that by far, the group that felt the least belonging to our university community were those that had conservative values. I mean, it was like 16 or 18%. Remember, Ms. Regent Rocha, asking questions that day?
I do, Regent Sigum.
In fact, Provost Croson, I said that had there been any other group other than conservatives, the university would have turned over upside down to hire faculty or to make conservatives feel belonged. I need to ask the question again. What have we done in 5 years? And there are a few students out there, maybe even a few professors that have some conservative leanings that they need to feel belong just as well as any other group, just as well as any other identifying factor we have. What have we done? And I don't know if that's in your survey or not, but it's true.
Yeah, I remember.
Thank you,
Provost Croson.
Chair Powell, Regent Swigum. So indeed, our philosophy and commitment is that everybody should feel as they have a place and a opportunity to succeed and thrive at our institutions.
regardless of race, ethnicity, socioeconomic status, religion, and of course, political orientation. That is not a question that the CERU survey asks, which is where this particular data and that comes from and this metric is tied to. But I'd be happy to work with Vice President for Equity and Diversity, Mercedes Fernandez, to talk a little bit about how we might integrate that into the climate survey that we're intending to run this spring.
Well, Mr. Chairman, thank you. Thank you very, very much. I understand it's sensitive to talk about, but the fact is everybody belongs. Everybody needs to feel belonging, and there are folks out there who don't. And I hope it's not out of line, but I do have it in my folder at home. I will get a copy of that survey and pass it on to yourself and to each of the members here who weren't there in 2017. And I don't mean to be offensive when I do that, but you know, information, facts are kind of stubborn things. They don't go away, you know, they stay there. We need to address it, Rachel.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Regent Sawyer. Regent Mayeron.
Yes, thank you. I have a question. We go through these comparisons as we look at each of the individual campuses, and we list the comparison group institutions. And I would like to understand what are the parameters or guidelines that we give to each of those campuses in terms of who their comparators are. Do they decide who their comparators are? Does central administration decide who the comparators are? And are we looking at, for example, I'm looking at Crookston. Here we're looking at data that has to do with four-year graduation rate, six-year graduation, comparing Crookston against other colleges or universities around the country. In terms of, as we analyze that information, is that the same group that we might look to if we were looking at benchmarking for compensation for employees or faculty? Are we going to look to the same group for comparators? Are comparators those who Crookston feels they most compete with for students? In other words, I'm trying to get an understanding of what are the factors that creates this comparator list. And who decides who's a comparator and for what purpose?
Chair Powell, Regent Mayeron, that's an excellent question. It's one that I have asked since arriving at the university. There are indeed some natural comparators that we might think about. But as I know has been discussed here in the compensation space, when you're talking about compensation for staff, for example, it might be that private industry is a better comparator than other universities. When you're talking about compensation for faculty, other universities might be a better comparator. So I think it is natural and appropriate that there may be different comparison sets for different purposes. My understanding for this particular analysis is that Mr. Carlson, who was mentioned before, worked with each chancellor to identify the appropriate set of comparators. But I can certainly look into that and get back to you. If the board, you know, wanted to identify a fixed set of comparators for a particular purpose or for all purposes, I'd be, you know, happy to participate in that discussion as well.
Just as a follow-up, but the reason I raise this, for example, when we look at tuition, then we pull out a set of comparators for, and we compare Crookston to other institutions, and I don't recall if it's the same set that's here, but I'm guessing it's not. There may be some overlap, but I'm guessing there may not. Indiana University at Kokomo, I'm guessing may not be someone, I don't know, that we are looking to compare tuition and that we're worried about losing students to that university or that system campus versus our own. So I do think getting an understanding of who are the comparators and for what purpose is important. Ideally, you'd be looking at the same set of institutions as, I don't know if it's ideal or not. But we need a rationale. If we're not going to look at the same institutions for comparison for tuition or for compensation or for graduation rates, then we need a reason why, I think, to having that variety within each of those campus comparisons.
President Gable.
Yes, if I may, Regent Mayeron, it is standard practice to have different peer groups for different questions. The idea of who, if we're just carry on with your example, Crookston might lose students to, is a very different decision and set of attributes than the amount of research an institution does, which is the standard practice for setting salaries as peer comparators. So it is unlikely that we would ever have just one set of comparators, but a rationale for why we have each set makes perfect sense and is something that we could easily, well, not so easily, I'm looking at Link, we could pull together.
And Regent Mayron, we were, Secretary and I were just chatting a little bit, and I would just echo what the President just said. I mean, the idea that this board would review, who's on the list, you know, from time to time is, I think, a good idea. And so there should be some, you know, understanding and endorsement of that. And the other critical factor is that that list has to stay stable over time, and or it's, you know, really almost useless. So I mean, I think there's some follow-up thinking that we can do here on to make sure that we've got the right governance around the comparator list. Follow-up or other questions?
No, thank you.
All right, thank you. Regent Farnsworth.
Thank you, Chair Powell, and thanks for the report. I have a quick question about an article that I had saw in the Star Tribune from December 2nd around the U's Native American Promise tuition program, and I had sent an email to some colleagues and our staff to ask about it, and Executive Director Steve suggested that this presentation might be an appropriate time to ask about it, so I'm going to. In the progress card, there's the goal that says, quote, increased percentage of BIPOC / underrepresented ethnicity in parentheses, undergraduate students in the freshman class. And I guess I was just looking perhaps for a little dialogue or expansion of where our U's Native American Promise tuition program is at, which I think is an excellent program. And so I don't want to confuse anyone by thinking that I'm questioning it, and just want to see how, you know, some reflections and thoughts about how we might be able to build upon that and give that opportunity to more folks. And I saw from the article my colleague Regent Tad Johnson's thoughts on that, so I appreciate that, but was looking for maybe some more thoughts from administration on this part, of course, as it relates very directly to the MPAC 2025 strategic plan. Thank you.
Provost.
I think President Gabel wanted to chime in this
okay,
one.
Okay, there you go.
So with the provost certainly, with the opportunity to correct me for anything I get wrong, but Chair Powell, Regent Farnsworth. So the Native American Promise Program is part of a very three-dimensional and portfolio approach to our overall commitment to strengthening our relationship with our tribal community partners. It's part of our reckoning around the complicated history we have with the sovereign nations in the state of Minnesota, and it was a starting point. We have had a significant uptick in the number of Native American students who enrolled, as well as our overall percentage of BIPOC students in the incoming class, which, if I'm not mistaken, overall was up 25% year over year, with similar improvement and growth amongst Native American students. But, and as I'm now, I'll say borrowing rather than borrowing words from Karen Diver, who's the senior advisor to the President for Native American Affairs, it's still a very small population that we would be drawing from. The number of Native American students in Minnesota who are likely to be freshmen in college is a small number of people. And so I think we have to have an understanding of what it would mean for that program to be successful. For it to be successful, ideally, every student who is eligible would take advantage and come, and over time we would also increase the eligibility, both of which are underway. But as a start, it was more than 10% of the students who came in, and we expect to see that on an upward trend going forward. So we are delighted and honored to be able to have this starting point and are fully committed to and acknowledge that there is still more work to do.
Thank you, President Gabel. Follow-up, Regent Farnsworth?
No, I just want to thank the President for that, and I thought I'm genuinely curious about it from how we can strengthen and improve, and thought this would be a good opportunity to kind of elevate what we're doing and where we might be headed, so thank you.
All right, thank you. All right, Regent Rocha, you'll wrap us up.
Well, thank you, Chair Powell. For a question for Provost Croson first. So, because I always find myself reacting a little bit when we talk about the largest class or the most Minnesota freshmen, because for those that were here during the 80s, the campus had 20,000 more folks on campus. But one of the challenges that we had was we had a lot of folks that weren't pursuing degrees, or they were admitted to a program that didn't offer a degree as an opportunity to move into one. So when we talk about the largest classes, are we measuring those that are enrolled in degree-granting programs as opposed to, let's say, 1988, where there were, again, more folks on campus, but probably a smaller cohort that were actually admitted to degree-granting programs? Is that an accurate statement?
Chair Powell, Regent Rocha, I'm not sure I can speak to what the 70s and the 80s. I will say that this is our second largest class since 1987, I believe is the, or since we were, oh. Since a particular date, and I don't get, you know, firm up what that date is.
In 35 years.
Well, thank you, sir. Well, and again, but even the challenge then is we had an extension program that a lot of folks took one class. They were interested in begonias or, you know, it's something that where there was expertise, they took that class as somewhat of a community development, but they weren't looking for a degree. But our academic leadership was saddled with that as a number of students, and then that was reflected in a very low graduation rate because that person wasn't moving on. So just wanting to understand, I don't know that this is a really huge issue, but I just always obviously want integrity in our statements and, you know, as far as how many people we're serving. Very happy to hear that the percentage of Minnesota students is high. And in the modern world, of course, we know that non-residents are very important part. A low percentage fill out FAFSAs, they have resources, and in a lot of schools, they're a big part of keeping the cost down for resident students. And I think that that's an area that we can continue to address. If I had the magic wand, we would have the lowest resident tuition in our conference or among our peers, and we'd have the highest non-resident in that we would have the reputation, and I believe we do have a very strong reputation, but in order to attract folks like that, there are a lot of upsides to that. And then, of course, within that, you can always target support for non-residents with the resources that come from that. So I will say that over 8 years, we've been moving in the right direction in terms of the gap that reflects the fact that it is created as a resource for resident students, just as Iowa sees the University of Iowa and Wisconsin sees University of Wisconsin. So, the topic that was raised by Regent Spigum, which I understand is not squarely on this because it's not part of the evaluation, I do think it gets to part of it. It gets to our mission, and then part of it gets to a little bit what you see as somewhat of a divergence from a geographic standpoint in our capacity to attract students. I'm proud of the fact that higher education university, the University of Minnesota, is part of a higher education structure that was created, you know, in the mid-19th century, that it has been a part of the progress that we've made in discussion of ideas. And I would note that a lot of the prevailing ideas now and the people that hold those prevailing ideas, were they in another time, they would have been the smaller percentage and they would have been nervous about, you know, speaking their views because they would have been, you know, likely would have been critiqued, to put it lightly. And so one of the things that I do get very nervous about is, you know, again, what is in vogue today, 50 years from now, people will look at things that we're doing right now with very good intent and with their judgment determine that we are somehow wrong in history. I think that's just a reality. If you look over time, views change. And I get a little bit nervous. There was on the president's wonderful report earlier, there was talked about a process for identifying misinformation. The word misinformation immediately draws a little bit of concern for me and somewhat of an Orwellian panic, because it can be a very subjective analysis. And so I always want to be very, very sensitive to the fact that, you know, a university environment really should invite the craziest range of views, because what we consider now today to be absolutely fundamental truth, two generations ago it would have been considered absolutely crazy. So I think that's very, very important. And to the extent that you do have this kind of divergence, perhaps more than any other time, where folks that have certain perspectives feel as if they are not welcome. It's reflected a little bit in the way over time we've treated speakers on campus. Some speakers, you know, go to Northrop Auditorium and there's a very large presentation, or perhaps even one of our sports facilities, where other folks, you know, end up in smaller ones. And when I asked a question about that, this is quite a few years ago now, maybe probably even before 17 Regents Vigham, I was told, well, it's easier for us to provide security in that smaller location. But that also prevented a lot of people from being able to participate, and also gave the perception to the people hosting that event that they were being disfavored because another speaker of a different perspective was given a larger venue. So these are just things as you go forward in your governance role on this board to be mindful of the fact that the easy thing is to allow this just to kind of go. The harder thing is to do our job, which is to make sure we are a place where many ideas can bump up against each other in our effort to try to improve society. So by doing that, I think that you also become a more welcoming environment. You're seeing that our rural areas, which tend to have a slightly different political leaning than our metropolitan core, our numbers are low. A lot of students, you know, are not coming here. Part of it is geographic, part of it is financial. They're being targeted heavily by surrounding states, but another part is they have a perception, at least, that they would not be as welcome here as they would be in other locations. And again, the easy thing is we've got plenty of students, right? We're doing just fine in that regard. But if we're really doing our job and serving every corner of the state, I think we need to make sure that it's a hospitable environment for all folks. So appreciate the work that you're doing. This is very great, very good data for us to analyze, and I appreciate it.
All right, thank you very much. That concludes this discussion. We'll come back in February to look at this report again and approve it. So thank you all for the conversation. We'll move now to the report of the Faculty Consultative Committee and the Senate Consultative Committee. Professor Colleen Flaherty Manchester, she chairs both of these groups. We always look forward to these updates from our shared governance partners. And Professor Flaherty Manchester, floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair Powell, members of the board, and Vice Chair Mayron, and President Gable. On behalf of my Vice Chair, Mark B., and my colleagues on the Faculty Consultative Committee, as well as the Senate Consultative Committee, I want to thank you for this opportunity to present to you, the board, the fall semester report of these groups. As a reminder, the FCC is the Executive Committee of the Faculty Senate, and the SCC is the Executive Committee of the University Senate. And the University Senate has membership from all four constituent senates. In addition to serving as the Executive Committee of their respective senates, these groups are also the steering committee of the set of committees that report up through those senates. And finally, most relevant to my comments for today, these two committees have a consultative charge. They receive the concerns of their constituents and advise university leaders on decision-making by elevating the perspectives and experiences of these constituents. This early input on decision-making processes through these consultative committees, in addition to the administration's response to legislative action through the senates, are key tenets of robust shared governance here at the U. So I'll begin my report by sharing the priorities of the FCC, the Executive Committee of the Faculty Senate, and where we stand in terms of getting traction on these priorities. The priorities of the FCC for this academic year are faculty reinvestment, elevating the concerns of fixed-term faculty, and increasing inclusivity and transparency within shared governance. I'll start with the topic of faculty reinvestment. So the FCC recognizes the central importance of student success and discovery and innovation as the two of the commitments of Impact 2025. The FCC also recognizes that these two commitments are ultimately built on a foundation of faculty and staff engagement. Over the past 2.5 years, the COVID pandemic and the social justice movements ignited by events in our city have placed faculty engagement under enormous strains that are now worsened by historically high inflation. Data from the fall 2021 university-wide engagement study corroborates this recent strain on faculty engagement. In particular, faculty as a whole experienced a large decline in engagement since 2019, with just 41% classified as engaged and 59% classified as something other than engaged based on the Office of Human Resources definition. Given the intense experiences of the past 2.5 years, the FCC saw it as critical to be proactive in reaching out to faculty to hear their perspectives and experiences in order to meet its consultative charge. Through multiple channels, including a February 2022 town hall with faculty senators, a design thinking forum in May 2022 on the future of employment, the employment relationship between faculty and the university, and on a survey of faculty senators from the summer on what efforts would have been most positive on the faculty employment relationship. All this input has pointed to faculty reinvestment. Reinvestment in faculty is an investment in the university's current strategic plan. The top three areas identified by survey respondents as having the greatest potential impact in terms of a positive impact on faculty employment relationships are compensation, recognizing undervalued work, and protecting time for big work, including creative and writing that is as a necessity to delivering on the university's three-pronged mission. All these areas are forms of human capital investment and wholly consequential to the university and its ability to deliver on its mission. So the FCC is committed to taking action to advance progress on these three areas of faculty reinvestment. To date, we've been actively working with the Provost's Office on developing ongoing recognition for efforts that faculty put forth at the local level to make their units a positive place to learn, work, and be. For compensation, we're asking questions about short-term and longer-term human capital investment strategies and elevating the importance of what we're calling the three R's, which is recruiting, rewarding, and retaining faculty and staff. We often hear about the university's commitment to recruiting and retaining faculty and staff, and indeed, recruiting and retaining faculty, staff, and students are part of Impact 2025. But by comparison, we hear far less about the importance of recognizing the ongoing contributions of faculty and staff who are dedicated to advancing the university's mission. And we appreciate efforts by President Gabel, Provost Croson, and board leadership to engage with us on these critical conversations. For the FCC's second priority area, elevating the concerns of fixed-term faculty, there is a new subcommittee chaired by Catherine Dowd, Administrative Director of the School of Mathematics, and it's dedicated to the experiences and concerns of fixed-term faculty, and this subcommittee reports through the Senate Committee on Faculty Affairs. In addition, this fall, the Faculty Senate passed a two-pronged resolution authored by the Academic Freedom and Tenure Committee that sets up a task force to examine questions of academic freedom protections for fixed-term faculty and faculty like PNA employees, as well as highlights the reporting of fixed-term faculty appointments with an eye towards informing a broader conversation about the role of fixed-term faculty in the delivery of the university's mission. As a final priority to share, the FCC has worked with the Senate office staff on practices and procedures aimed at increasing transparency and inclusion in how legislative actions move through committees on their way to the Faculty Senate. This effort includes new action tracking, as well as available on the Senate website, development of thorough consultation plans, as well as procedures on the Senate floor. A recent example of this inclusive practice is the recommendations from the Task Force on Faculty Misconduct in Graduate Education and its journey to the Faculty Senate floor. In my role as FCC, I'm also chair of the SCC, which again is the executive body of the University Senate. The primary priorities of the SCC actually overlap to some extent with the FCC and include longer-term human capital strategy for employees, understanding implications of PEAK, and enhancing transparency and inclusivity for bringing legislative action to the University Senate. In addition, the leaders of the four consultative committees meet regularly to increase communication between the four Senates and coordinate on shared interests. And these interests have included campus safety and fostering feedback loops on changes occurring with the implementation of PEAK. I'll report on one formal action taken by SCC this fall. The SCC was closely following the developments surrounding the October 2022 Board of Regents meeting. After discussion with the committee voted to write a letter dated October 28, 2022 to the Board of Regents that elevated the importance of the Board of Regents' Code of Conduct for members in their role as stewards of the university. The SDC is keenly interested in the board's commitment to diversity inclusion training and including whether the university's own experience could be leveraged in this pursuit and how the university might use this experience more broadly as an opportunity to reflect and lead. With that, I conclude my report.
All right, thank you very much. All right, Regent Davenport.
Thank you. Out of the gate.
Sure, thank you, Chair Powell. And thank you for that report. I've been waiting for this because I've been very anxious, interested to hear the results from the design thinking sessions that were held in February. Am I correct in what I think I heard? And that is that shared governance is alive and well here at the University of Minnesota, and that's reflected in using that February design thinking, those sessions, listening, then taking what's been heard, put it into an action plan, and then following through with and with some accountability. Did I hear right?
Chair Powell, Regent Davenport. Yes, I think that's an astute observation. So it's, you know, with the change of the last 2.5 years, there's been, you know, some disruption to how we typically do or had done our shared governance work. And so this past year, we've been doubling down in our efforts to listen and making sure we're hearing from across the constituents, and more importantly, show action, as you mentioned. So we've had a lot of opportunities for taking in information, and now we're trying to get traction on that. And so we're really continuing to ask questions about how best to do that. You know, in our conversations that we regularly have with President Gabel and Provost Croson, you know, we ask those questions. You know, how can we move the needle on these on this idea of for the FCC faculty reinvestment, right? And so I think part of what we were doing is trying to assess what are the most important, you know, priorities. And I think the three that we have identified are, you know, compensation matters, recognizing undervalued work, and then protecting time for big work. I think those three things have really rose to the top, and we're looking to see how can we take action on those.
Thank you.
Follow up, Regent Davenport? No, okay. Regent Farnsworth.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you for the presentation. I apologize for having to step out, but we can hear the meeting in the back room. I don't know if people know that. But so I appreciated listening to your presentation, and just a comment and a question. First comment, as a former student senator and university senator, I really have come to, got to personally appreciate the work of the Senate structure and know that it's a huge time commitment, voluntary commitment into shared governance, which is really makes our institution stronger. And so I wanted to sincerely thank you and the rest of the university senators and student senators and P&A civil service. Well, I guess university senators covers everybody. Wanted to thank you directly, but then extend that thanks to your colleagues for your service in our really important shared governance apparatus. The question is around engagement, and it's on my mind. Well, again, engagement's always on my mind, but I had the opportunity to meet with, at their invitation, the P&A Consultative Committee last week to have a specific conversation around engagement and the work that our board has been doing in governance and policy around that. And we had a very interesting, very in-depth conversation about a variety of things, and it made me think to ask this question of you today, remembering that I don't remember when this was, but I know we did small groups and then different breakout sessions through Zoom with the FCC on various topics, and I still remember some of the things that were discussed there, and that was very beneficial and enriching and meaningful conversation. And so I'm just wondering, outside of this report, if there's other ways that the FCC, SCC sees would be beneficial to hear from and engage with the work of the board. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor.
Chair Powell, Regent Farnsworth. I just wanted to clarify, you're talking about kind of engagement in terms of how they approach the institution and their work, or engagement with shared governance? Can you clarify?
Like what else besides, how in what other ways besides this report could we be engaging with or hearing from the FCC and the SCC?
Yeah, thank you for that. I think, yeah, our meetings are all open, so we would recommend, we would welcome anyone visit. We've had visits with board leadership this fall. We're planning for a similar Zoom-type engagement early in the spring semester around some questions, potentially around this link and helping us understand the connection between faculty and staff engagement and student success, so maybe having some dialogue there. We're having a planned, I think, more casual interaction in the spring, and those are the opportunities I see on the horizon, but I think it's great to hear that you were present and engaged in the discussion with the P&A Consultative Committee, and I encourage members to take those opportunities.
Yeah. Follow up? Yeah, no, just wanted to say thank you and look forward to discussing future opportunities, and again, just mainly express my appreciation, and I'm sure I can do that on behalf of other colleagues as well. For your work, and I'm only getting up again because I just realized I have raspberries all over my hands, so thank you.
All right, thank you. I think Regent Hips and then Regent Rocha.
Okay, thank you, Chair Powell, and thanks for your great report. I'm also concerned about the engagement piece, and I think it's it's what's happening now, not only in the public sector, but also the private sector. We're seeing all these reports of quiet quitting and low engagement. And what was the engagement before 2019? It said in your report that it was a sharp decline.
Yeah, I don't have the number right here. Sorry.
Thank you.
Chair Powell, Regent Hipsch. I'll have to look back to my notes. I know Brandon Sullivan from OHR had done a presentation to this group in September on those numbers as well. But I think what struck me was the sizable decline across the board, but even more so for faculty. So that really stood out. And I think, you know, if you think about those different boxes of engaged and frustrated and, you know, detached and disengaged, I mean, it's from my perspective, and I think more generally, we should be concerned if 59% of our faculty are something other than engaged, right? And so, and then we can maybe argue about the level, but I think the decline is what really kind of stood out to me. And I think you're right that this is a wide scale problem, but I think it's still important for us to figure out how we're gonna solve it here.
Just a quick follow up. I think we can all agree that low engagement is gonna lead to less student success. So more engagement is gonna be where we need to be. And so I don't know how we get there, but thanks for working on it.
Thank you, Regent Hips. Regent Rocha.
Thank you, Chair Powell, Professor Flaherty Manchester. It's really quite remarkable to be in your position with your area of expertise. I think it's fascinating, and I'll tail off a question that follows Regent Hipsch's and then a more general question. When we look at this workplace, the dissatisfaction at the university or this sense of disconnectedness, you know, just looking at polling of the community at large, there seems to be a kind of the misery index has taken a bit of a jump in recent years, and which of course is very interesting and hard to necessarily get our arms around. Is that kind of sense of disconnection, would that be something that you'd see in the workforce outside of the university as well, at other employers? Is there that same kind of sense over these last several years, or do you think that that's something that's fairly unique to the University of Minnesota?
Chair Powell, Regent Rocha, thank you for that question. So I think that, like we were kind of just mentioning, Regent Hipp's question, is that this is something that is more broad scale. We've heard about the great resignation that, right, you know, right, happened the last 2 years. I think what's unique about higher education, and actually my research, as you mentioned, kind of dovetails with this, is that, you know, the intense work of the pandemic it's very protracted, right? So it started off very intense, and it has lingered, and it persists, and it's led to changes that continue to affect our work. And so I think what's important to recognize for faculty, you know, that change in engagement was the largest among our employee groups. So I think there, even though overall there could be average changes, we do need to look at kind of pockets across. And I think what's important to know is, like, other work didn't get taken off our plates, right? And so this goes for staff as well. More work has been a driver, I think, of this low morale. And so I think, and then added to that, the inflationary pressures of the external environment have kind of compounded that feeling.
Mr. Chair, that leading into sort of the awkward transition to this question is, you know, we just saw again in the report of the president that, you know, we were named by an external evaluator as the best place to work in Minnesota, and as I've gone around and interacted with people from across the country in different institutions, Minnesota is known as being strong in our shared governance. Those two concepts, are those views shared by the faculty at large, or is there a bit of a disconnection between the perception from the outside and what we're feeling from the inside?
Chair Powell, Regent Rocha, that's a great question. I think that there might be a little bit of a disconnection, particularly for those employees most impacted, right? So I think what's important about the pandemic as well is that the effects were not uniform. So research that I've done shows that some, in the early events of the pandemic, some faculty were actually able to gain traction on the research agendas because of the way the demands were coming in for the type of research that was valued, as well as the remote environment. However, there's a sizable chunk of faculty, disproportionately women, disproportionately those with caregiving demands, who faced a double whammy of high burnout and declines in research productivity, and those two things are potentially reinforcing and are going to, from my perspective and that of my co-authors, present a significant challenge as we think about our faculty ranks going forward because of those self-enforcing in a negative relationship between those two forces.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Regent Rocha. Regent Verhaelen.
Thank you. Chair Flaherty Manchester, thank you very much. And actually, I would like to key off something you just talked about, which is those faculty who not only are giving themselves at 100%+ in the classroom, in their research, but then in their home or outside commitments. And one item you mentioned as you spoke was the space for big work and the space for creativity and writing. And, you know, I hear those terms and I think about personally recharging. And I'm really interested in your thoughts, either right now or as we go forward and further feedback, both for purposes of the university, but I see this as a larger problem within our society in general, which is just the pull in all of these places, and then something starts, as you said, you see impacts on their research time, which then is a personal piece where they're then taking that and saying, I don't have enough time to give to this, or I don't have enough energy to give to this, which is then also self-defeating and deflating. And where can we take that to make sure that people are finding that time to breathe and be thoughtful and really recharge and have those opportunities for creativity? I think that that's so important because it is that innovative drive, right, that we're seeking to encourage. And maybe it's more of a dialogue than a question, but.
Yeah, Chair Powell, Regent Verhaelen, thank you for that question. So in May, I was an online participant on a writing hunker. So I'm a huge supporter of writing hunkers, and this is a program on a shoestring budget out of the Center for Writing here at the U. And there were 20 individuals in that room, and the concept of a writing hunker is that you clear your schedule for the week, and it becomes the excuse to say no for that week. And we started off that hunker, and people were sharing their thoughts, and it was after they worked for a four-hour writing session, and we kind of had lunch and did it again. And they said things like, this is the first time in 2 years that I've been able to have a morning to work on my research. Right, and so how can, I mean, that was just for me. I get, you know, the chills just been thinking about it. And so how can we institutionalize this idea of having and being able to say, no, this time is for research. I need to push that other thing out. These little tasks that often take away at our chunks of time, I think they're bigger than the sum of the little tasks, right? Because they amplify, their effect is amplified by taking away those you know, whether it's 2 hours or an hour to kind of dedicate to a paper or a project. And this is a faculty issue, and it's also staff too. I mean, we expect our staff to be able to be innovative in thinking about longer term projects. And so how can we as an institution prioritize culture and practices for facilitating that time for big work?
Thank you, Chair Powell, if I may. I really appreciate that. And, you know, I explain it to my child as my brain needs time to, like, slowly uncoil. It's so tight and dense that it just, that time to unwind a little bit. And I really look forward to further suggestions from the FCC and how we can support faculty and staff in those types of arenas as well. As you said, it's critical to the three-pronged mission of the university. So thank you.
And thank you, Regent Verhaelen, for the questions and comments. I think that Professor Gable, President Gable,
Professor Gable, Professor Gable,
yeah, would like to close us out on this topic.
Thank you, Chair Powell. I actually was a professor for a lot longer than I was. So I just want to take a moment of privilege, actually, to amplify something that was said earlier, which is, having spent time at other universities, this is the most functional, robust, meaningful, consultative shared governance that I've ever been a part of. And that happens because the people who step up to lead, like Colleen Flaherty Manchester and Vice Chair Mark B, who we'll all see more of soon, members of PAC and civil service are, and the student government are so sincerely interested in the quality and excellence of the institution and the individual needs of the communities they represent without thinking that those two can't coexist functionally and successfully. They can, and I think they do here. It doesn't mean we don't have work to do in order to improve, but there is a lot of optimism about the likelihood of those improvements because that is what we spend our time on rather than in things that can often distract from the shared values and shared goals. So I just want to express my appreciation, and none of that would happen without the support of this board. So thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, President Gable, and thank you, Professor. We appreciate the update, and obviously highly engaged.
Thank you.
Let's take a 10-minute recess, and we'll come back at 11:25. Okay. We are back in session after the recess. We're going to move on to our next item, which is item 9, which is an update on public safety efforts on the Twin Cities campus. I want to welcome Senior Vice President Franz, who I believe will be joining us on the screen. And while we're getting his picture to show up, President Gable is going to frame up our status.
Thank you, Chair Powell, members of the board. So since our discussion in September and my update to you in October, we've continued to take important steps regarding safety on campus and in the community surrounding campus with our ongoing commitment to safety in a nuanced way, safety in every sense of the word and for all members of our community through the lens of their lived experience. So crime on campus remains relatively low, but we do recognize that crime that occurs off campus very much affects our campus community, and we've leaned into that. We've responded with increased law enforcement support. We launched Operation Gopher Guardian, which paid for the overtime of 10 UMPD officers and MPD officers to patrol Dinkytown in the Marcy Holmes neighborhood. We've continued to use university dollars to pay Minneapolis police to patrol neighborhoods adjacent to campus. We want to make staffing a top priority. We've been aggressively working to hire new UMPD officers while implementing a plan to increase the number of unarmed security officers on campus and available in these shared patrols. We've hired 5 community safety officers and renewed our contract with Block by Block for safety ambassadors Thursday through Saturday in Dinkytown. And we're working with the city and advocating for improved lighting in Dinkytown and Marcy Holmes, while initiating additional on-campus security measures. I also want to talk about some of the ways that the university supports students, some things that maybe we haven't talked about in this context before. In the event that one of our students is the victim of a crime, the Office for Student Affairs Care Team works very closely with UMPD to assist students as they navigate the challenges associated with a moment like that. This team can connect with departments across campus on a student's behalf if the student wants, and coordinate academic, housing, physical, and mental health support. Communication and support are also provided to parents and families of our students. The Aurora Center provides crisis intervention, advocacy, information referral services, and emotional support specifically for survivors of sexual assault, relationship violence, stalking, and harassment. And I'll make a final note that the University Student Legal Services helps students with assistance through the Victims of Crime Act. They may also work with students who need to file complaints with the city or the county, or make referrals and help with insurance claims where appropriate. And that's just a sample. So members of our board, Senior Vice President Franz is here, and we'll take a deeper dive into these and other actions we've taken. But before I turn it over to him, I want to recognize the resilience and commitment of UMPD. Over the last year alone, our approximately 50 officer force, just 50, has worked countless overtime hours to manage off-campus crime, even though UMPD is responsible for and specifically charged to protect and serve within our campus footprint. We are very grateful to them. They are doing a lot. We are growing the size as quickly as we can, but with the size that we have now, they are definitely outkicking their coverage. So we're committed to taking action to keep our community safe, and in that context, I'd like to turn it over to Senior Vice President Franz to continue the presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, President Gable. Senior Vice President Franz, over to you. Welcome. Hope you're feeling better.
Thank you. I am. Thank you. Chair Powell, thank you. Vice Chair Mayron, and members of the board. As the president noted, we have continued to invest resources to support the safety of students, faculty, staff, visitors, and residents in our area. I'd like to review several items with you at this time. So first, Operation Gopher Guardian was a short-term initiative that we piloted for 2 weekends from November 4th through November 12th. The university paid the overtime for 10 officers from both the University of Minnesota Police Department and the Minneapolis Police Department. The assignment was to patrol Dinkytown and the Marcy Holmes neighborhood, in addition to UMPD's regular patrol complement, which now routinely includes patrols in Dinkytown for our officers working overtime. There were no reported critical incidents or high priority calls during the first weekend. And I might add that first weekend, we had many scheduled events on campus. That weekend, we had a reported 26,000 folks visiting the campus for different activities over that weekend. But we must report, however, two carjackings were reported off campus in Marcy Homes during the second weekend. As we responded with increased police presence for Operation Gopher Guardian, we must acknowledge that crime cannot be fixed with increased police presence alone. Even in a neighborhood, on a weekend where we flooded the area with law enforcement, crime happens. This is where we ask the city of Minneapolis and the state of Minnesota to help provide protection for their residents with better safety infrastructure, more police presence, and an effective criminal justice system. We will continue to call upon the city and the state legislature to fully fund and support the university's public safety initiatives. Now, in addition to the safe you notifications that we get, which alert the community to crime that has occurred or immediately adjacent on or immediately adjacent to campus as defined by federal law, this fall, the Department of Public Safety partnered with the city of Minneapolis to offer Dinky Town alerts. This was to enhance our communication with the campus community about safety in a limited area of Dinky Town. Now, these alerts cover areas that are off campus and not the primary jurisdiction of UMPD, and therefore they are only sent when UMPD verifies and receives information from the Minneapolis Police Department. Unlike safe you notifications, faculty, staff, and students must opt in to receive these Dinky Town notifications. This is a pilot program that began in September under Chief Clark's supervision, and we will be evaluating this in January to determine further steps. Also, as the president noted, we are aggressively recruiting new UMPD officers and increasing the number of security officers and hiring additional community service officers, all with the intent to provide security to our community. I am pleased to report that we have 8 new UMPD officers who will join our team on January 23, bringing our complement to 55 out of 71 authorized positions. We also renewed our contract, as the president mentioned, with Block by Block for safety ambassadors Thursday through Saturdays in Dinky Town for another year. We reported at the Finance and Operations Committee yesterday our request for the university to invest in Dinky Town with the purchase of the former Gray's Restaurant at 325 14th Avenue Southeast. This request was approved by the board earlier in this meeting today. This purchase supports our work to improve safety around the Twin Cities campus by showing the university is committed to the neighborhood's vitality and ability to attract renters and other visitors. We support Dinky Town as a compelling destination for everyone who visits and lives here, including students, faculty, staff, neighbors, families, and others. We're also working with the city of Minneapolis and advocating for improved lighting in Dinky Town and Marcy Homes. Many of you are aware of the need for additional lighting in that area. Our community relations director worked closely with Xcel Energy and the city of Minneapolis on a lighting audit, which has just been completed. The audit noted where the lights are out and who will fix which lights. Just this week, both the city of Minneapolis and Xcel informed the university that they have addressed every lighting issue we identified in that audit. We thank them for their quick response. We advocated with the Minneapolis mayor and city council members to include the cost to add lighting in Dinky Town and the Marcy Homes neighborhood in their final budget just adopted recently. The council voted on the measure on December 8th, and the outcome was approved, although the funding was apportioned across the city of Minneapolis. Finally, we provided the various neighborhood associations and business associations in Dinky Town and with information about the Xcel Energy program called Xcel Night Watch. This program provides additional low-cost lighting for outdoor parking areas. And we want to give our thanks to Xcel for helping us publicize this program to those residents of Dinky Town and Marcy Homes. We've contracted with Allied Security to provide additional security to staff to patrol parking facilities on the Minneapolis campus. On the West Campus, we are addressing a 19th Avenue ramp security issue. Parking and Transportation Services has closed one vehicle entrance, the Riverside vehicle entrance, and all pedestrian access points to enter the 19th Avenue ramp as a pilot project. A security evaluation will be included in the next few months to address what changes we've made to see if they're working. Now, the security program to install locks in residence hall bathrooms continues. Bailey Hall is complete, Pioneer Hall is complete, and we will schedule Comstock Hall as soon as the lock installation parts arrive. In October, we surveyed students who live in on-campus housing. We chose this group because by and large, they are new to campus and will help us gauge their understanding and the use of safety resources, as well as our communication resources. We received more than 700 responses. In general, the data show that students understand the university has resources for them. 68% of resident students agree or strongly agree that they know how and where to access safety resources. 75% of respondents agree the university has resources and tools they need to feel safe on campus. Three most recognizable safety resources are SafeU notifications, Gopher Chauffeur, and 624 Walk, our security walk escort program. Now, to make sure students have information about when it is most needed, University Relations is now working in collaboration with the Office of Student Affairs and the Department of Public Safety to create resource cards for students who are victims of crimes. These cards would connect students to community and university resources that can support their mental health and well-being and work to remove barriers to academic success. I also want to address crime rates on and around campus to clear up any misconceptions. On campus, crime continues to be very low, thanks to the work of our community, Chief Clark, and the Department of Public Safety and all of our employees there. We know crime in the neighborhood surrounding campus continues to be a concern. We are monitoring current trends and working with the Minneapolis Police Department to address those trends. This fall, Minneapolis introduced Operation Endeavor, a partnership between Minneapolis, the Minneapolis Police, prosecutors, and violence prevention teams to reduce violent crime around the city. After the end of the year, we expect to see more data on the impact of their efforts. Early indications are that they are succeeding. Now, through these updates, we are focused on public safety on and around the Twin Cities campus. I want to mention again the University of Minnesota Safety Plan that I touched on briefly at the Finance and Operations Committee yesterday. The safety plan is directed by Commitment 5, Fiscal Stewardship Action Item 5.4, to assess and improve campus safety. We issued the first safety plan in December 2021. As a reminder, the plan is built off Dr. Cedric Alexander's report in 2020 that was delivered in early 2021, MSAFE Implementation Committee's work of the Office of Equity for Equity and Diversity, and other strategic planning efforts across the system. The plan has identified 5 safety goals and serves as a roadmap for a holistic approach to continuous improvement for safety in the broadest sense. The plan of the December board materials reflect our progress since last year. Over the past several months, all campuses have added campus-specific actions and metrics to indicate how they will enhance safety on each campus and support the safety goals. We will update this plan at least annually and provide another report to you next December. We will also post the materials online following this meeting. And as always, we work closely with the Campus Safety Committee under the leadership of Dr. Edgar Arriaga, who has been a fabulous in working to provide us with the opportunity to engage on a regular basis with university faculty, staff, and others. I want to thank UMPD Police Chief Clark, just like President Gable did, and the entire staff at the university's Department of Public Safety for their dedicated service and the positive attitude they all bring to our community in their service. They serve with distinction and a lot of overtime, and thank you to them for doing that. Finally, I want to echo Chair Powell's comments in his chair's report this morning, where he asked all of us to support safety. I also ask all of us together in our shared community to support safety, which I strongly believe includes being safe and feeling welcome and respected. On behalf of President Gable and all of us that work for the university, we take our safety responsibilities seriously, and we need your support to be successful. I truly believe that safety is everyone's job, no matter where you live, no matter what you can contribute. We can all make difference working together. Thank you, Chair Powell.
Thank you, Senior Vice President Franz. While I'm waiting for the questions to line up, let me
I'll quickly ask this question. Very encouraging to hear the new eight new officers will be coming in January. That's very significant increase. That should help a lot. So I guess the question is that related to timing of, you know, the graduation of officers? And maybe if you can comment on when you think the next tranche, you know, might be available to add to that total of 55. And then the last question is, do you have a sense for movement in the city of Minneapolis to on their goal to get back to that 750 strong force?
Yes, thank you, Chair Powell. I think on the first issue, one of the things that we do see is that these officers tend to come in waves. We try to, part of it is for our training at the university. We try to bring in classes, and there are only so many people we can handle in a class of training that they go through here at the university. They also have to be trained, as you alluded to, in some form to be hired, but then they have to go through our own special training here at the university. So we're really at capacity in terms of being able to process these new candidates. So we will be looking to have them, once they get onboarded and active, we will begin searching for yet another class to bring on board in the near future as well. Our goal, obviously, is to reach the 71. You might recall that the authorized request we made to 71 officers was designed to make sure that we had at least five officers per shift 24/7. And so we're not able to do that at this point, and we can do that when we get to the 71. And with respect to the city of Minneapolis, we are in constant communication. In fact, Chief Clark and I have meetings with the top Minneapolis officials on Monday in regard to public safety to get a better understanding of their commitment to increase the number of officers that they're bringing on board. As I mentioned, their Operation Endeavor has yielded some success, and it shows that attention and focus and targeting can help focus our efforts in ways that can really highlight those really serious violent crimes that we're so concerned about. But they are working very hard and give us our assurance they're doing everything they can to bring on board new cadets. But, we have to, and that's one of the reasons why we're right now in negotiations with our own law enforcement bargaining group, and we continue to work with them. And we need to make sure that we attract and retain the very best officers that we can. And Minneapolis has to do the same thing, as well as every jurisdiction. In rural Minnesota, they're experiencing some of the same problems in terms of having the adequate people to patrol some of the rural counties and cities. So this is not a unique Minnesota problem or unique Minneapolis problem. It's a problem that all jurisdictions have to address. And part of the issue does become one of resources. As these salaries go up, which they should, we're going to have to make sure that we can match those salaries and attract new officers.
All right, thank you. Regent Farnsworth.
Thank you, Chair Powell, and thank you, Senior Vice President Franz, for the report. As the Chair and others know, I think these reports at our full board meetings are really important, so I appreciate it. And also want to thank as well our Department of Public Safety, UMPD, for the incredible work they do. I've had the chance to have some more informal interactions this fall with our officers and all of those great folks, and just have got to learn up close and personal by listening about the incredible work they do. So I really appreciate that. Just a couple thoughts or points of feedback, and then one clarifying question. Listening about the resources for victims and then the resource card that you, Senior Vice President Franz, talked about, that was some new learning for me, and I think in a really positive way, particularly around resources for students who may be victims of crime, and then not just students, but resources that extend out to their support system. And so I think, and this may have already been part of it, but just wanting to make sure, there's a lot of different resources that we put out, of course, about a whole host of things in different formats. And so that resource card or whatever materials are put together, that goes, that's presented by some engagement, some communications campaigns, that we're able to elevate that through the many other resource cards that we have for many other things. And so I'm sure that was already being thought about, but whether it's working through, the Greek communities or the different communities we have to make sure that is presented, but there's also some conversation as well to inform students and their support systems that we have those resources. The second thing I wanted to say is that I appreciated the clarity, Senior Vice President Franz, about the question I asked at the end of our committee meeting yesterday around the MPAC 2025 report around safety and what that was. And you addressed that today, and I really appreciated that. And that gives me some more understanding, just because kind of as we dissect our various institutional safety work through that report, through the Campus Safety Committee, MSAFE, you know, what are all these different entities that are, of course, contributing to the same mission and all part of the body of work that we're doing. It's just from a structural standpoint, maybe I'm the only person interested in dissecting that. I think that's helpful to understand. The last thing I'll say, and then I'll get to my clarifying question, is I'm hoping, you know, as we, I think we all understand and have had many conversations about physical boundaries when it comes to what our responsibilities and relationships are with what happens on our campus versus what happens in adjacent neighborhoods. And, you know, that sometimes is more of a gray area, but particularly with Cleary and kind of how those boundaries can set themselves up. And as we continue to work in collaboration with the city of Minneapolis and different entities, you know, I'm hoping that we can, I think it's important about how we talk about our works. And when we talk about their residents, as in the city of Minneapolis, I think it's our students. And all of our folks that are living in these, our students, faculty, and other university community members that are living in our adjacent areas to campus and in these other areas. So that's just a small thing. And then just to, my clarifying question is on the funding for new lights from the city, or the lighting funding from the city, which is great. And congratulations to the team for getting that done. I know there was a lot of effort and a lot of conversations. I thought I had read something in an earlier communication that it was more for repair and replacement. Just to be really clear, that is funding for new additional lighting units, or am I wrong about that? That's my question. Thank you.
Senior Vice President.
Mr. Chair and Regent Farnsworth, well, thank you. Yes, the lighting issue is for new, and but it was spread around the city, as you may have heard also, and that's, you know, based on a fair and equity kind of an issue to make sure that the entire city of Minneapolis needs us these services as well as we do in Marcy Homes and other areas. So it is for new lighting. I do want to mention, I really appreciate your comment about the victim card, the resource cards that we're putting together. And we're open to new resources there. And we will consult this process and get more suggestions and ideas. We want it to not be a well-kept secret. But, you know, part of the problem is no one anticipates being the victim of a crime, right? So if you don't look at this and go, oh, well, I guess I should keep this somewhere. So, you know, that's kind of the challenge, is to making sure that it's out there in a way that people can easily find it and people know about it and they can refer a friend, kind of a thing sometimes. So, but you're right, though, the communication and the developing those resources is underway, and we appreciate your comments. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, Regent Rocha.
Thank you, Chair Powell, thank you, Senior Vice President Franz. You know, this has been a really important issue, and I'm gratified that we've seen improvement in some of the numbers. I know that we're in a bit of a seasonal shift, which can have an impact. I echo Regent Farnsworth's appreciation for the work of University of Minnesota Police Department. I know President Gable, you did a ride along. I was fortunate to do a ride along and get to see the intensity of the work. It's pretty remarkable, and I've just been so impressed with the folks that I've met. Chief Clark and his team are amazing. I've also had a chance to go on a couple of safety and security walks around Dinkytown, and it's, to the lighting point, it's stunning the difference between a well-lit area and a dark area. And lo and behold, that also reflects the patterns of crime in the area. They tends to follow that fairly significantly. And you know, from that standpoint, I think that any investment we can make in this regard is critical. You know, you can talk about employee satisfaction, you can talk about shared governance, you can talk about quality of education, graduation rates, but if it's not a safe environment, it's all for naught. So I think that this is really critical, and I would hope that if we use this pause that sometimes comes with Minnesota winter to really prepare for when things warm back up and we can maybe expect a little more activity, I think that's a good thing. My question is, and I've raised this before in this dialogue, we know that the safest place for students at a university like ours is in dormitory housing. It's controlled It is very advantageous for students on a range of levels, but yet we have the lowest number of dormitory beds per student among our peers, and we're in the highest density area, to my knowledge, and we would have, of course, the greatest need. As we talk about safety and security, increasing the access and the number of dormitory beds for our students, has that been part of the conversation, and would it be part of the conversation as we try to recognize that this is not an issue that's going to go away with some magic answer, that it's a continuing issue that institutions like ours face in perpetuity?
Senior Vice President.
Thank you, Chair Powell, and thanks for the question, Regent Rocha. You know, one of the things that that we do look at is the amount of activity and supervision that does occur on campus. And we do note that has been a very good source thus far of not seeing a spike in crime on campus. You know, one of the things we look at when we do compare ourselves to other universities, we are somewhat unique. There are only a few campuses like ours that are in the middle of a major metropolitan area. And so that has a couple different kinds of ramifications. I mean, first of all, the private sector has stepped in and made some of those investments in and around the campus, which is nice. It frees up the university to do other things. But you know, as you mentioned, there are trade-offs with that. And one of the things we're looking at, and I think we saw this in the Twin Cities campus plan that we discussed this last year, and that was looking to the future and providing those areas where we think there is a potential for growth for on-campus housing. And part of the issue, obviously, is maintaining, and as you understand, when all those of costs, the construction, the investment, the maintaining fall to us, it's not an insignificant burden. Not that we shouldn't do it, and we obviously do it a lot for the entering freshman class primarily, but I think we clearly are going to always be analyzing what is going forward. You know, do we have the resources to commit to the resources required in increasing on-campus housing, or are we better able to support the city of Minneapolis in the future to make sure that the areas where this housing occurs is safe? It's a legitimate ongoing issue that we will always address, and I appreciate the question, and I don't think we ever put it to bed, so to speak. It's something that we always think about. What's the right mix, and how should we invest going forward? There's so many, you know, as we talked about yesterday in the Finance and Operations Committee, there's so many competing interests for our resource dollars, and this is a valid, you know, concern to think about, and I appreciate your comments on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. If I can just a reaction. Thank you for that answer. I note that, you know, with dormitories, as I understand it, over time, that they do have a cash flow effect. There's the bonding requirement or the coming up with the money, and so that is an issue. I would just hope that the board, in its approach to seeking to deal with the safety and security going forward, would place as a priority increasing the number of dormitory opportunities to bring us, if not in alignment with our peers, but perhaps even more so. But I do appreciate the answer. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Senior Vice President Franz, for that report. Very helpful. Much appreciated. I'm sure it won't be the last conversation that we have on safety, but we do appreciate the update and the progress that's being made, and also the, you know, as you have said several times, we all, I think, so appreciate the dedication of our university police force. So thank you. All right, we'll turn now to the next item, which is a discussion of a new medical school academic partnership. Dean Jacob Toller will present this for our review, along with Ken Holman, who is the president and the CEO of Centricare. They'll outline a letter of intent, which is before us for our review today. And I think we're going to go straight to Dean Toller to kick us off on this discussion. So, Jacob, welcome. Great to see you. And Mr. Holman, a pleasure to meet you.
Chair Powell, Vice Chair Mayron, Regents, Madam President, it's always a delight to be with you, and it's especially cool today because I have with me my friend, Dr. Holman, who is special. You know, some of you know that already, but I got to learn this in a process, because he's one of the leaders of healthcare in the state state of Minnesota. He is a physician who spent quite a bit of time at this university, and he has been remarkable in his ability to understand that academic medicine is a humanizing force in the healthcare business today. I have been taught by him, you know, sometimes implicitly, sometimes explicitly, a lot of things about how to go about our presence for the whole state. And I'd like Ken first to ask for a couple comments that you can say about yourself.
Dr. Ulmer.
Chair Powell and Regents, thank you for the opportunity to be here. There's one thing we all have in common. We all live together on this globe that spins around. We share a common humanity and a common destiny. And I think the ultimate goal of a university in a healthcare setting is to listen and guide, serve and heal, because your health and the health of your loved ones is really important. So while this is about an academic collaboration, it's about the health of our citizens and our communities, and particularly in those communities in outstate Minnesota, which have some remarkably different needs than the metropolitan. And I echo the thanks to Jacob and his entire team as we've worked through this the last few years. And thank you, President Gabel, as well, for your support over the time.
Chair Powell, Regents, Madam President. So the vision in front of you today is the Rural Health Academic Partnership. Every single word of these four is important. It's rural, you know, not to forget people who live outside of the big cities and big hospitals. It is health. There are very few things that are as fundamental for our well-being as health. We all know that. It's academic because really the winning app in the medicine in general and especially in the healthcare business in the United States is academic, and it's a partnership. It's an alignment of the virtues and parts of our organizations that are viable and that are so important in their synergy. So that's all good. But the problem is fundamental. The problem is great. And the challenge that our predecessors and your predecessors had, we always knew this. We have been admiring the front side of the problem, recognizing that this is a problem, but we have never looked at the backside of the problem. We have never looked into the, you know, disassembling the complexity and hierarchy of the problem. And we have always said it's there, so it's not new. What is new is that we want to do something about this. And it's embarrassingly simple. If you want to have healthcare in rural Minnesota, you have to have doctors and clinical teams in rural Minnesota. I apologize almost for the, you know, for the pedestrian part of that, but that's what it is. So we always knew the answer, just never done it. At least not done it effectively. So in the rural America in general, there's going to be 80,000 rural physicians gap by 2030. That's enormous. That's an enormous problem that's in front of us. And the data are on this slide, how different the life of our fellow Minnesotans is outside of the big cities. And it's the distance, it's the access, it's the inability to get the preventative medicine, to get the interventions, to get the treatments, to really get to the simplicity of getting to the care if there is a minus 20 weather outside and it's 2-hour drive. Okay, simple as that. So what is in front of us is how can we grab that diagnosis that we have made? Many people have made this, it's a problem. And how do we get to the solution that actually is actionable, that it actually is effective, and that brings to Fergus Falls or elsewhere the magnificence of what the academic medicine can bring. And rather than spend more time on this, we felt that we can show you a video.
Across Minnesota, we know that our rural population is aging. Along with that aging comes more health problems. compounding this whole situation is the fact that our rural healthcare workforce is dwindling.
People know that we don't have as many doctors in rural Minnesota as we need. What they may not know is that we don't have as many rural people going into medical school and becoming doctors.
As our communities age, our physicians age too, and we have to replace those primary care providers, those nurses, those APPs, those respiratory therapists, those lab techs.
Ensuring that just because we live in a rural geography, the people we serve will not get inferior care.
We recognize that there are significant gaps in healthcare in rural America. We also recognize that the solution to filling those gaps and addressing those issues means having an educational and a professional and a career development that is based in those communities.
If you want people like doctors practice in rural Minnesota, you train them in rural Minnesota because they will develop extramedical relationships. They will be friends with the families that they have taken care of there.
So how do Jacob and I, the University of Minnesota and CentraCare, collaborate and create an environment where we can be successful and bring that learning, that education, that expertise to you?
We want to make sure that people get the right care at the right time, at the right place, and that right place is as close to home as possible.
So we have a partnership with CentraCare on their St. Cloud Family Medicine Residency Program, and it's been a wonderful partnership.
Our residency program has a focus on training for rural practice.
But it has been shown time and again in various parts of the country that if you train people in the rural areas, they tend to remain close by.
I came from a smaller town and I wanted to raise my family in a smaller town. In residency, I went through my training in St. Cloud, where they have a focus and an emphasis on training rural physicians for full spectrum family medicine. I think it's important for that training to occur in a rural area because the type of medicine that we practice is so different. Those patient relationships and community relationships are a lot different, and the breadth of what we do is different. So I really think it's important for training to occur in a rural area so that the practitioner can be fully trained in all of the aspects of rural medicine that you don't get when you're practicing medicine in a big city.
It's been such a joy to get to know my patients over the last 20 years and to see the elementary school kids that say, I want to be a doctor when I grow up. And I usually say to them, that is so good, and I want you to be a doctor because I need to retire someday. And that's why this project is so important, to be able to recruit people that are from small towns, make this an avenue for them to learn to practice in a small community.
University of Minnesota has been around for quite some time and has gathered that gravity of having real excellence, competitive excellence in education, in training of the physicians, and having the ability to partner with others.
In most of our communities, healthcare is a major force for doing good. Doing good. Economic development. Jobs.
And this is going to be incredibly important, not just for healthcare, not just for the attraction of the physicians to rural Minnesota if you train them there, but for the society in general.
We want to participate in that journey with you, a patient, a community member, a medical student, a resident, a staff member. Let's do it together.
Thank you, Chair Powell.
Yeah, thank you.
It was cool. I noticed that Ken is moving much less his hands than I am, you know, when we speak. Anyway, this is so cool.
It's called age. Yeah.
No. Age is all here, Ken. You know, it's not in your body. So we are not starting from scratch. That's really important. This is this Board of Regents has been visionary in your and your predecessors' commitment to rural Minnesota in Duluth. You know, we have a campus there, more than half a century there, and we have done a lot of good on your behalf in that area. We are not starting anew in St. Cloud.
With CentraCare, we have 20 years or more of family medicine residency there. We have one of the best orthopedic groups in the state. I am grateful to my chair, Dennis Cloese, for his leadership in that area. And we are certainly experts now with Associate Vice President Prasad, who is in the audience, in the rural training. We have started what's called Rural Preceptorship Associate Program, RPAP, decades ago, and that is exactly it, that you put the trainees with the physicians in the community so that they get, you know, that's their home, that's their personality. And we have had a similar program for the urban areas. We call it MetroPAP. In addition to that, we are starting these rural training track programs. We have one that's going to be come reality on your behalf in Wilmer soon. So this is not starting from nothing. We are really trying to take the investment that you have put in this medical school, who, by the way, is getting to the very top decile. I cannot say exactly the number because it's not official yet, and it gives me a great amount of pain and trouble not to be able to say this, but next time I'm here, I will. So you have this top-notch medical school that now can let its breadth and depth being partnered with a superior healthcare system in the state, and I'll have Ken describe how this actually works.
It's just a great opportunity to be here representing the roughly 13,000 employees we have. We take care of roughly 700,000 Minnesotans in 43 counties. And the impact that we have is not just about healthcare. It's how we create a sense of community. You can see on the slide in front of you some of the reach that we have in terms of hospitals, clinics. We affiliate with a number of other hospitals who are not a part of our system. We have had a number of partnerships with university over the years. And the intent of this is perhaps to view it in a phased approach that really gets at what we call making rural life healthier. So if you envision an educational process that involves medical students, it piggybacks and builds on our residency programs that have been present for some years. We have a number of state schools in our geography, St. Cloud State, St. Cloud Tech, Wilmer, and the list goes on. How do we expand educational opportunities for all the team members that we need in rural health, nurses, LPNs? We have roughly 1,000 students in CentraCare facilities contributing to the future of healthcare. There has been a historical brain drain to the metropolitan area and workforce drain to the metropolitan area. So this notion of how we create advanced access to not only primary care, but also tertiary and quaternary care is really important. And that requires a partnership. That requires us to build on current models using organizations who have a similar vision and mission. The University of Minnesota, land grant, research, education, healthcare, CentraCare, we are here because in our communities, we are who they look to for healthcare. We're a major employer and we're a major force for doing good.
So in front of you today, we are sort of opening, you know, this for your consideration. We will come in February to this board and ask for your approval of what we call statement of interest. And this is what it's going to be. It's going to be very simple. As we said several times, I'll repeat it again. If you want to increase the number of physicians in rural Minnesota, you train them in rural Minnesota. That's it. That's what we're going to do. We have a good business plan behind this. We have a good program management behind all of this. But essentially, it is not just using physicians as widgets, using them as a sort of a helicopter, I'll train them there and just drop them over here kind of thing. But let them live in that community. Let them be part of this community in a more than just medical sense of the world. Because in our personal lives, you know, we are more than physicians, really. You know, like you are more than lawyers and you know, other specialties that we have. And we will be very intentional about putting all the three missions of this University of Minnesota Medical School at service in this partnership, because it is a truism, but it necessary to repeat it again. If you want to have the highest quality outcomes in clinical care, you do it with tools that involve innovation, discovery, and education. That's what it is. That's how you do it. And that commitment from Ken and his team and simultaneous desire on both parties is to co-develop this, to co-lead this, and to have really a merged, aligned vision, the shared purpose with which we can remove the barriers, we can design the interventions that work, and we really have the in front of us the vision being used to get stuff done and drive the events using that that vision. So with that, your guidance, as always, and your support will be essential, fundamental, and I am deeply grateful for your invitation here today for both Dr. Holman and myself. Chair Powell.
Great. Well, thank you. Thanks to both gentlemen. And while we're again waiting for hands to raise and questions, I'll kick it off with one. Well, first of all, I'll just say, just speaking for myself, this seems like a tremendous opportunity for us. It seems like, and it's not sort of something that starts today. I mean, this is an ongoing partnership that's been building over time, and this is sort of the next step. But as we, get into the discussion, it'll be important for us to understand really some of the metrics and the numbers and the kind of the concrete facts about the partnership that's being proposed, just the financial requirements and commitments that both of us will be taking on. I think we'll just need to see that. And also, in terms of guidance from the Office of the General Counsel as we engage, in this partnership, I just think we've learned from experience that the governance, how it's designed, how it's set up, the various roles, those become, as both of you know, really crucial. And so we'll need to see those components fleshed out, I think, in order to make a decision. Having said that, I'll turn it over to Regent Hipsch.
Well, thanks, Chair Powell, and what a great presentation. I wish I had more than two thumbs to give it more than two thumbs up. I can't do that, so. Well. But when it comes to, I'm rural, obviously everybody knows I'm from Perm by now, but it's so important to have this healthcare in these rural communities. You guys can't even believe how that's such a limiting factor in our growth. Because people will move to communities where there's doctors and there's, we have the hospitals, we just need the doctors and the nurses and the staff. And this is gonna take us into the next 100 years if we can get this right. So I think it's really, really imperative that we do this, and I wanna commend you for bringing this to us. And I think we have a lot of people that can do it, we just need more capacity for education. And I can't tell you how happy I am to hear this, because this is really gonna, we have jobs like crazy. We produce things and we value add things in our rural communities, from lunch boats to barrel farm potato chips to whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And we're not gonna have those jobs in the rural areas if we don't have the medicine out there. And so thank you for bringing this to our attention, and hopefully we can be helpful on your quest forward. So thank you.
Yes, Chair Powell.
Chair Powell and Regent Hoops, I love what you said. Alan Arvig has been a fan of this for some time. I've talked to him several times. And the notion of technology to improve rural health is something that Jacob and I have really focused on, because that is the way to improve health in a time of diminishing resources and access. And so this notion of how we take advantage of, we need to remember that healthcare exists in two places at the same time. It is really high tech nowadays, and it's really personal. And that's what we want to do both. Thank you.
Chair Paul, Regent Hipsch. I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Dr. Toller, go, and then Regent Hipsch, come back to you.
Just a quick, Arvigs are huge supporters of the EU as well, and they're looking at their second and third generation are both University of Minnesota graduates, and what goes around comes around. So if we can help them, they can help us, so.
Chair Powell, Regent Hipsch, I'm going to amplify one thing that you said, Regent Hipsch, and then I'll comment on what Ken said. It is a different balance sheet. You see, in front of us, because we are land-grant university and we are different, you know, we are a unique resource for the state, it is the balance sheet of conscience, because it's unconscionable in many ways. It's morally imperative in a way to do that, because we are here to do this, and very few people actually would have that ability, you know, as this partnership can do. And to Ken's point, if I may, the healthcare as you know it is going to be totally different in 10 years. And the reason is this, you know, that there are two populations in the United States and elsewhere. One is the baby boomers, the, you know, now 65 or something, and the second is the, no, he's about 53. Then the 25-year-olds to 45-year-olds. So the baby boomers are, this is just too much of the disease burden. My typical patient is a 74-year-old with 3 diagnoses. You know, you just cannot do this. You know, the business of healthcare here is not built for it. So you need that technology, that digital renovation or renaissance of whatever you want to call it, to help you with this. And it's actually a beautiful thing, because not shockingly, patients want to be close to where they live. They don't want to cross that river that we call 694, you know, because they want to stay where they are. And from the healthcare system and clinical system, it's actually much better, because the distributed network of highly functional units that you, Regent Hip, refer to, that's exactly what's going to keep the people there, because that's what we want to do. And for the 25-year-old to 45-year-olds, it's going to be patient-guided. You see, they will not take this anymore. They will not take the way much of the healthcare business today is being performed. They want to be in control, and they will be in control. Chair Powell.
Right. Thank you. Regent Hibbs, did you have another comment? Okay, anyone else? All right, thank you. Dr. Johnson, thanks. Ruth.
I just want to express to the group how enthused I am about this. I think it's very exciting. I think it's really important. That as a Minnesota is a state with great medical care and great reputation for that, great training, but we need to be where we're needed. And this is a wonderful partnership. In the time I've been on this board, I've got to know Dean Tolar. Full disclosure, I've known Dr. Holbin since he and I were classmates and pre-med students at Augsburg University together. So I know the course of his career. He's outstanding. Physician and leader, and I think this is going to be a wonderful partnership. Look forward to hearing more and working together with everybody to try to make this happen.
Thank you. Thanks, Regent Johnson. Yes, you'll have the last word.
Okay, thank you.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Regent Johnson. Thank you, Chair Powell. I'd like to have you consider this proposition. How do we become a more perfect union? Yesterday they released more JFK material. And we all remember, of course, the ask question that he asked. And I think coming out of a remarkable period of world events, and by the way, Jacob and I talk like this, so you can forgive us both. How do we make a difference? How do we start creating an opportunity for all of us to move forward, even in rural environments? And this is a big step forward. Thank you, Chair. Thank you, President Gable, and thank you, Regents, and thank you, Jacob.
Very good. Excellent. Really appreciate it. Look forward to seeing you guys in the new year. All right.
Thank you, Chair Powell, everyone.
Thank you. Thanks.
All right. We'll turn now to item 11, which is the East Cliff Property Task Force and the recommendation of the East Cliff Property Task Force. Just as a reminder, in May of this year, the board adopted a set of strategic real estate principles intended to guide the acquisition and the disposition of property. Then in September, we directed the establishment of a strategic property planning work group. And that group was charged with using the guiding principles to determine the potential properties for either acquisition or disposition. At that time, the board also created an East Cliff Property Task Force charged with considering the retention or disposition of the property in alignment with our principles.
Under Regent Davenport's leadership, that group has been working diligently to bring forward recommendations for our consideration. And this has been very hard work. And Regent Davenport, we really appreciate your leadership on this. And over to you now to share the task force's recommendations.
Thank you, Chair Powell, and thank you for reminding my colleagues that we did look at this and formed the task force in September as part of the broader review of the university's strategic property planning that's being done in alignment with the MPAC 2025. As you recall, the task force was charged with considering the retention or disposition of East Cliff in alignment with those guiding principles for the acquisition and disposition of property as stated in our policy. So first, let me thank the members of the task force for their good work. That included Senior Vice President Myron Franz, Vice President Matt Kramer, University of Minnesota Foundation, President and CEO Kathy Schmidlkoffer, Associate Vice President Bill Paulus, and I also want to thank Vice President Kramer's team in University Relations for their good work, and specifically Laura Johnson for helping her get these materials that you have in front of you. The task force also wants us to acknowledge, and we acknowledge, the significant impact that the Brooks family's donation of East Cliff has had on the university history. The donation created a very unique and special place for presidents, their families, and numerous guests. The task force concluded that maintaining East Cliff as the president's residence using university operating and capital funds is not central to fulfilling the university's missions or the objectives of MPAC 2025. The task force recommends that current public resources used to support East Cliff operating and capital costs be allocated to support the university's mission and goals. Now, the task force did hear from members of the East Cliff Advisory Board that encouraged our exploration of a philanthropic endowment to support the ongoing operating and capital costs. We listened to that, and given that request, the task force asked the University of Minnesota Foundation, and they agreed to conduct a feasibility study to ascertain whether it would be possible to obtain the philanthropic support necessary to offset the ongoing operating and capital expenses in perpetuity. As noted in the report, the task force estimate, or we estimate that an endowment of between $15 million and $20 million would be needed to do just that. So the study is currently underway, and the task force will report back in February with results and a final recommendation. Thank you, Chair Powell, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Questions, Regents, while waiting, maybe I'll ask Regent Davenport. So based on the estimated endowment that we would need, that would translate into that the operating costs, but you know, a combination of annual expenses and capital runs between $750,000 to $1 million a year. I mean, is that the right range for the cost of operating the property?
Right. If we look at, say, a $15 million endowment, and we look at what we would hope to be at least a 4% return, that would be $600,000 a year, or 1.8 over 3 years, and then hopefully two. That endowment base would grow.
Okay, all right, thank you. Questions? Regent Farnsworth and then Regent Mayron.
Thank you, Chair Powell, and thank you to my colleague, Regent Davenport, and everyone else who's doing a lot of hard work on this. I think this report was really helpful. It was also helpful. I don't know about other colleagues. I had a chance to go over and do a tour with staff, facilities management staff at East Cliff somewhat recently because, you know, being new to this board and being a regent that was elected during the pandemic, I've only really been to East Cliff a handful of times for different events. And having not really been around before that, it was nice to be able to have that opportunity to learn from the staff who have the expertise for managing East Cliff, learning more details about the facilities and capital needs and realities of maintaining a historic property such as East Cliff and all the challenges around that. And so that was really helpful. And so I guess I'm supportive of the plan that's in place and using some time for the foundation to do that due diligence and the feasibility study and then the timeline of coming back with a recommendation in February. And it seems like we definitely have all the right folks in place to bring different perspectives and expertise to that work. And so as someone who, yeah, just has kind of very limited experience with East Cliff, but has been listening and learning about this process, I think the approach that we're taking seems to be right. So thank you.
All right, thanks, Regent Farnsworth. Regent Mayron.
Yes, thank you. I have, over the years, had many opportunities to attend events at East Cliff, dating back, well, at least when I was on the board of the UMAA and prior to that. There's a huge emotional attachment to East Cliff, and it's so much part of our fabric of the university. I'm very aware of that. But at the same time, I'm really a great believer in this policy that we have developed to help analyze whether we should retain or dispose of property. And it's unfortunate for me that in some sense, our first test is going to be this very unique piece of property that, as I said, is so much part of the fabric of the university. But where I land is, unless we can find a way to continue to finance its operations, its repair, perhaps through philanthropic endeavors, I think applying the principles set out in our policy dealing with acquisition and disposition of property, I think we may be forced to make that really hard decision of letting the property go. And I hope we don't have to get to that point, but I am prepared to get to that point if necessary, because I do believe so much in this policy that we've developed to guide what are some really tough decisions, and this will be a tough one. I recognize that.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, Regent Davenport, don't see any other questions. Your report was very clear. I think we all understand, you know, the next steps, and we'll be back at it in February. And thanks once again, because I know this has been, you know, a lot of outreach, a lot of communication. This is, as Regent Mayron just said, this is not an easy one, and we're really grateful to you for taking point on this. Thank you. Okay. We'll turn now to the reports of the committees. We'll follow our normal practice for consent reports, which is if there were multiple items voted on in the committee, all the items recommended unanimously will be taken together in one vote, unless a member of the board would like to separate any of those items from the motion. So we'll begin with the report of the Audit and Compliance Committee. Regent Kenyanya.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The Audit and Compliance Committee did not consider any action items this month. Our agenda included three discussion items. First, the committee received the external auditor report from our external auditors at Deloitte. I'm happy to report that the financial audit had no material findings. For our second item, the committee held an overview of the request for proposal process, RFP process, for a new external audit contract from our Director of Accounting Services, Molly Viola, and our controller, Sue Paulson. The committee will receive updates, and ultimately the board will approve the new external audit contract. For our final discussion item, Chief Compliance Officer Boyd Coomer presented the annual institutional compliance and annual conflict of interest reports. Those reports provide a summary of compliance risk assessment summaries, U-report statistics, consolidated reports of misconduct, and the conflict of interest program. Mr. Coomer did note that that report would be updated to reflect recent additions. The committee also received an information item reporting an engagement less than $100,000 requiring after the fact reporting with an external auditor. Thank you, Chair Powell. This concludes my report.
Thanks, Regent Kenyanya. Regent Hipsch, will you report on the Litigation Review Committee?
Thanks, Chair Powell. The Litigation Review Committee met yesterday. At this meeting, we adopted a resolution that authorized the closing of the meeting to discuss matters subject to the attorney-client privilege. Thank you.
Thanks, Regent Hipsch. All right, mission fulfillment. Regent Davenport, please, will you give us your report?
Thank you, Chair Powell. The Mission Fulfillment Committee had two action items this month. The committee voted unanimously to recommend approval of the commercialization of intellectual property rights, Board of Regents policy, and the consent report, which includes a number of academic program changes, conferral of tenure, the human fetal tissue research report to the Minnesota legislature. I move approval of the committee report.
Okay, and these were all approved in committee unanimously. Okay, so we'll take them all. Are there any questions or comments on any of those? All right, seeing none, Regent Davenport, you're moving that we approve all of those?
Yes, I am.
Okay, so that's the motion. Is there a second?
Second,
okay. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right, that motion carries. Moving on to the Finance and Operations Committee, Regent Mayron.
Thank you. The report of the Finance and Operations Committee includes eight items this month. First, the committee voted unanimously with Regent Verhaelen recusing herself to recommend approval of the amendment to the lease of 150 Broadway Avenue South, Rochester, Minnesota, for the Rochester campus. I am going to move approval of the real estate transaction and would request that Regent Verhaelen recuse herself from the vote.
Okay, that has been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
Second, thank you. Any questions or comments? All right, hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right, that motion is approved. Regent Mayron, any additional committee business?
Yes, thank you, Chair Powell. Next, the committee voted to recommend approval of the conflict management plan as amended. I move approval of the conflict management plan as amended.
All right, the conflict management plan has been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
All right, thank you. Any further discussion on the conflict management plan? Regent Farnsworth?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just like yesterday, I would request a roll call.
All right. Okay, we'll take a roll call vote on the conflict management plan.
On the conflict management plan, Regent Davenport.
Yes.
Regent Davenport votes yes. Regent Farnsworth.
No.
Regent Farnsworth votes no. Regent Hipsch.
Yes.
Regent Hipsch votes yes. Regent Ruth Johnson.
Yes.
Regent Ruth Johnson votes yes. Regent Tad Johnson.
Yes.
Regent Tad Johnson votes yes. Regent Kenyanya. Regent Kenyanya votes no. Regent Mayron.
Yes.
Regent Mayron votes yes. Regent Rocha.
No.
Regent Rocha votes no. Regent Swigum.
Yes.
Regent Swigum votes yes. Regent Taurabi.
Yes.
Regent Taurabi votes yes. Regent Verhaelen.
Yes.
Regent Verhaelen votes yes. Chair Powell.
Yes.
Chair Powell votes yes.
All right, so that motion carries 9-3. Regent Mayron, would you like to continue with your report?
Yes, thank you, Chair Powell. The other six items were unanimously recommended by the committee for approval by the board. Those items include the following: the resolution related to the proposed labor agreement with Minnesota Teamsters Public and Law Enforcement Employees Union Local 320, the resolution related to the proposed labor agreement with AFSCME Council 5 Healthcare and Non-Professional Unit Local 3260, the resolution related to the proposed labor agreement with AFSCME Council 5 Clerical and Office Support Unit Locals 3800 and 3801. The resolution related to the proposed labor agreement with AFSCME Council 5 Technical Unit Locals 3937 and 3801. The resolution related to the purchase of 325-329 14th Avenue Southeast, Minneapolis, and establishment and of an investment in the 325 14th Avenue Southeast LLC. And the remaining items in the revised consent report, which include 8 purchases of goods and services, $1 million and over, the 2026 Special Olympics USA Games Memorandum of Understanding, 5 employment agreements, 2 real estate transactions, and off-cycle tuition rate changes.
Thank you. Thank you, Regent Mayron. So all of those were approved unanimously yesterday. They're moved by Regent Mayron for approval by the full board. Is there a second?
I do a move approval of the items. Now yes. I need a
and
second.
There's a second right. From Regent Swigum. I don't see any other questions or comments. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? All right.
There were no other action items this month. Thank you, Chair Powell, and that concludes my report.
Okay, thank you. And then last but not least, the Governance and Policy Committee, Regent Verhaelen, your report, please.
Chair Powell, the Governance and Policy Committee did not consider any action items this month. That concludes my report.
Thank you. Thank you, Regent Verhaelen. Okay, that moves us on to our, moves us to, from our committee reports to old business. Any old business? Any new business? Hearing none, our meeting is adjourned.